Don't be stupid, boys. Turn off Clyde, support your side.
I would like to leave this city. This old town don't smell too pretty, and I can feel the warning signs running around my mind. And when I leave this island, I book myself into a soul asylum, 'cause I can feel the warning signs running around my mind. So here I go, still scratching around in the same old home. My body feels young, but my mind is very old. So what do you say? You can't give me the dreams in your mind anyway. Half the world away, half the world away, half the world away. I've been lost, I've been found, but I don't feel bad.
So everything is average nowadays.
Good day, good evening, good afternoon, or good morning, wherever you are in the world. You're listening to the Half the World Away Celtic podcast from HailHailMedia. My name's Kevin O'Neill, and I'm based in Mandurra in Western Australia, originally from Coatbridge, and all the way over the other side of the country, in Melbourne, Victoria, is my good friend, Mr. Patrick Close. Good day, Pat.
G'day, Kevin. How are you?
I'm very good. I'm very good. G'day to you, mate. Now, also on the show tonight, and I think this is the first time for a while we've had a full house of the regular panellists. Also in Melbourne, Victoria, we have Mr. Martin Kelly. G'day, Martin.
Hello, mate. How are you?
Very good. How have you been, Martin?
I've been good, mate. I've been good. What about yourself?
Can't complain. Can't complain. And also, we have got up in Osaka, Japan, Mr. Liam Carrigan. How are you, Liam?
Hi, boys. Good, good, thanks. Bloody freezing, but otherwise good.
Now, I heard that rumour. I heard the weather's been quite bad up in Japan.
I had snow all day today. Had to walk home to work because my bus wasn't running.
Did it remind you of being back in Scotland, Liam?
Aye, but probably, but just with slightly better looking women walking around me.
Oh, hey, controversial. <that.
laughs> Slightly, I said slightly.
And on Valentine's Day as well, Liam.
Oh well.
I'd just like to put a call out for all the women that ever went to Cleopatra's in Glasgow. I thought you were lovely, darlings.
Can you remember all their names, Martin?
There was quite a few Sengas, and there was.
Well, give them all shout outs, and we'll come back to the show in about half an hour.
And look, see the ones with their own teeth, they were particularly special. But no, I tell you, Cleopatra's in Glasgow, sensational nightclub, sensational. You know, chip shop across the road, what more could a boy ask for?
A kebab shop.
Aye, I suppose. It's lovely. It's shut down now. I heard it's some fancy new thing, but anyway. We're getting off the topic anyway.
No, we'll see. The last one we did a weather forecast. So just for everyone in the world, if anyone is actually listening, is anyone listening? I think we've got 11 people listening. It's a balmy, 25 degrees. It's 10 o'clock, 20 past 10 at night. It's still 25 degrees here. That's lovely. So what's it like over in Mandurah, Kevin?
Well, I'll tell you right now, wait a minute. Oh, funnily enough, it's a balmy 25 degrees and clear here as well. Lovely.
But we've got bushfires over here around the sort of suburbs of Melbourne, so it's a bit hazy, a bit smoky. Mm-hmm. So, yes, but anyway, that's another story for another day. So,
well, we might as well round off the temperature thing. What is it in Osaka, Liam?
Two degrees.
2 degrees. One more and we could have had a band from the 70s.
Lovely. Get it right up you, Liam. Excellent stuff.
Thank you.
Please, buddy.
I'm sorry, can you just hold on a second? I'm just going to turn up the air conditioning.
Yeah. Shower of bastards.
You're welcome.
Now, Martin, you've told us that you're going to have a short and sweet visit on the show tonight because you've got some romancing to be doing or something like that, or you've got to get yourself to beddy boys for an early rise in the morning. Is this correct?
That is correct. Now, it is Valentine's night, so, you know, Barry White will go in the CD player, you know, we'll put the lights on. Mm-hmm. I'll go into bed and maybe at some point my wife will join me, so, you know.
If you're lucky.
If I'm lucky, you know, you never know your luck, you know. But we're kind of that because I say I have to be up early in the morning. I've got a bike ride in the morning, so I can't stay on too long. But I'll take part for a little while.
And play it by ear.
Give you my thoughts on games that I've not seen, and then go to bed.
So, Martin, Liam, Martin, that could be two rides in 24 hours, I know.
Get that explicit label up ready for the show already. Liam, you were saying before the show as well that you were playing some Barry White before the show as well or something like that, weren't
I meant
you?
To say was I had a Barry White before I came on it.
We're down to see listeners. And there's four of us on it that are listening.
Honestly,
we had 13 listeners before, it's now down to 5.
I'm not surprised. Three of them are us. Right, this is a Celtic podcast after all, guys. So we'll get down to talking a little bit about Celtic shortly. But I suppose for all those other three that are listening out there, if you do want to interact with us tonight, the best way to do so is probably via Twitter, and you can send your tweets to @halftheworld88. So if you've got any comments or any questions, you'd like to ask us or comments you'd like to raise and we can have a chat about them, please feel free to do that on Twitter. If you do want to Skype us in as well, you can do that. It's again halftheworld88 is the Skype name, so you can look us up on there. As I always say, once there's quite a few of us on here, it can be quite a dodgy internet connection, and I know we had problems the last time. I was dropping out a few times as well. That might be a good thing, you may be saying. But yeah, if you do want to call in the show tonight, by all means do that on Skype. Or if you want to leave some comments in the Spreaker chat room, you can do that as well. So I think without further ado, chaps, we'll try to get on talking about Celtic and we won't talk about Valentine's. Well, maybe we should just mention one thing. 2 years ago to the day, that old team, Rangers FC, went into administration on Valentino's Day 2 years ago. I think it's the name of the show tonight as well. Rather than a happy Valentine's Day, it's a happy admin day. It's been a quick 2 years, guys, hasn't it?
Sure has.
Look, a lot's happened, and look, if a lot has happened, and I suppose in the run up when you know some people were saying this could happen, I think we never actually thought. I'll be honest, I never thought that they would be liquidated.
I would agree with that.
I would have thought a Fergus type guy would have come in, or I would have thought that enough of the supporters would have basically. Got them out of it. And I also probably thought that Scottish football wouldn't have let it happen type thing. Yeah. That's not having a dig at them. Look, I have said on here before, I believe in we should talk about Celtic, not about other Glasgow teams. But on this, I'm happy to have a discussion and say, I thought all of those and I am surprised how far it's gone. I also thought that the SFA, SP, whoever, all the governing bodies wouldn't have let them go down to third division. I never thought that. And I think that was sort of, fan power that forced on that. And I'm happy, if people would disagree with me and have a discussion on it or anything. But I think if you'd said a couple of years ago, right, literally, I think probably 3 months before the administration, boys, this is going to happen and it'll end with total liquidation. I don't think we would have believed that, would we?
I didn't. I must admit at the time, for those very reasons that you were talking about, Martin, they were the establishment club, and I just thought the powers that be would find some way of keeping them going one way or another. The administration thing was funny enough when it happened, but beyond my wildest dreams, I never thought they would die. But
I was going to say, I think it took fan power to stop them just being catapulted back in. I think the powers that be would have... And look, if you're looking at the SFA or Premier League or whatever being a business, then having one of your biggest draw cards out of it for 4 years or 3 or 4 years minimum, that's a big hit for my business. But from an integrity point of view, I don't think there was a choice on it sort of thing.
And I think as well as the fan power, one of the key, I guess, vehicles as well was social media, because the fan power could have been there anyway, but without that social media and the interaction between the various fans, which makes it a lot easier nowadays, of course, I think that had a significant part to play in it.
But don't you think, Kev, and again, what I'm surprised is that it didn't actually work the other way, so that when they did get in, the Rangers fans didn't seem to, join together. And, I think back to the Celts for Change thing and, there being little adverts put in, in newspapers and hadn't the Candlericks Hall, their meetings thing. In theory, it's a lot easier nowadays to do this sort of thing. You stick something on, follow the huddle, going, right, we might have us get together. What do you think? Let's have us. That just doesn't seem to have really happened. Like, there seems to have been, some stuff, but I suppose to me there doesn't seem to be that fan power. There seems to be two or three Rangers associations talking and stuff, but do you know the march in the street type thing? Is it just that we are too far away from it, or what do you think, boys?
Well, something I would say to that is, and I think actually that is part of what ultimately killed them. It was their own mindset. The Huns all had this idea, we are Rangers, we are the people. They can't let it happen to us, it will only happen. Mm-hmm. And they were in denial for so long that by the time it finally dawned on them that, guys, your club's going to die, it was too late for them to do anything. Whereas with Celtic, we didn't take anything for granted. We knew we had to get off our arses and save our club. And so we did,
Do you think, but also, Liam, that I suppose they are the establishment cop. That's, you know, I think that's sort of accepted type thing. I can see why they thought that. I can see why they thought, like, if we're saying ourselves, we didn't think they would go into, you know, I didn't think they would be liquidated. As I said, I thought a white knight, a blue knight, or whatever would come riding over the hill. And I actually thought the SFA and the powers that be just wouldn't let it happen, sort of thing. You can see why they thought that. It is ridiculous now, 2 years later type thing, but you can see why they thought that, where I think Celtic, we've always felt we've been, I suppose, downtrodden. So we're ready to march in the streets and fight against it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, do you think I'm just a wee bit too romantic about that? Or
you've got a point there for sure, but I think that the penny should have dropped with them. See when Walter Smith came out with his thing about, oh, you know, it's now the bank that's running Rangers.
Mm-hmm. Aye.
They should have clicked. It's like, you know, that this isn't right. Like, you know, when a couple of years before Fergus came in, the writing was on the wall at Celtic. It was obvious the Kellys were just running their thing into the ground. You know, mm-hmm. It became very obvious. And I think it was about 18 months before the administration. You know, the Huns were dead in their feet. They were, you know, they were struggling to put a team together. They weren't this dominant force they'd always wanted to be, you know. And even Walter Smith, who was like the arch Hun, as it were, he was mm-hmm. coming out and saying, you know, there's trouble here,
mm-hmm.
and they should have clicked at that. At that point, any other team would have realised something's got to be done here. But the Huns and their master race mentality is, you know, that's what killed them ultimately, I think.
So you have to remember the timing of it as well. The timing of it was from a non-Hun was probably perfect, because at that stage when they were trying to get back into, you know, some sort of form of Scottish football, that was around season ticket renewal time. Now, if this all happened 2 months later, all that stuff with Dundee United coming out and, you know, Raith Rovers and, well, not Raith Rovers, but, you know, probably more the Premier League teams, Aberdeen, that sort of stuff. Do you think they really would have went against, you know, this cash cow that was, you know, would bring X amount of pounds every single season, if they already had the season ticket money in the bank, do you think they would really have pushed against it? I think it was their fear of their fans basically revolting against them, saying, well, if you vote to let them back in the Premier League, I'm not buying a season ticket. And I think it was those threats. I think it was probably more start against, I guess, with Dundee United fans, and then probably Aberdeen as well after that. But if that, because Celtic obviously were strangely silent on it all, they waited until everyone else came out and said something, and then they went, we agree with all what they said. And that was pretty much, you know.
I actually think Celtic played in general quite a good one there, for the simple reason is they didn't want to be seen to be leading the charge, because this isn't, we're not the only one here that's got an agenda, right? Now, we can keep going if we want to, and right, but we don't want to be the one standing up the front saying, right, we don't want to let you, and everybody behind going, I will back you, we'll back you. No, mate, I don't know who you are. I think it was time some other boys stood up, and I think, Pat, I couldn't agree more with you. Season tickets, when suddenly you've got Dundee United fans and everything saying, you let them back in, no chance, mate, none of us are buying. So you may think you're doing the right thing by getting, I don't know, 10,000 Rangers fans to come, you know, twice a year to your ground. But if you've got no season tickets, you've got 7,000 or 8,000 people not there every week at the home game, sort of thing.
Yeah.
So I think you're right. I said timing wise, it was, you know, sort of all the stars either aligned or not aligned, you know, if you're a Rangers fan on that. But I still stand back and go, I'm still gobsmacked that they weren't, you know, leveraged in for whatever, you know, for some way. And I think it was, you know, other fans going, this can't happen, you know?
Mm. Like, we don't want to dwell on, you know, what Sevco and, you know, how they came about and stuff like that, but I guess maybe we should try and sort of finalise it by, you know, do you think, you know, we're obviously celebrating just today as Happy Admin Day, you know, second anniversary, but do you think there's going to be an Admin 2? I guess, just very quickly, do you think it's going to be an Admin 2?
Are you sure this is very quickly? This could be a quickly. Huge, because this is a huge topic of conversation right now, isn't it?
We could save the detailed conversation we could save for another day.
Oh, absolutely. But do you reckon
that it's going to happen again? Just, I guess, a yes or a no, but
I honestly think it could happen. If they don't rein themselves in very shortly, this little cup run that they're on just now is a drop in the ocean to what they're paying their manager and what they're paying some of their players and the bills that they still owe. It's not like the 50s and 60s when you did a bit of a cup run and it really made a huge significant difference to your income. A lot of these games, it doesn't make a marked difference at all. So if they don't rein themselves in, I can see it happening again.
What do you reckon, Martin?
Look, I think it can happen. And it's one of the basic economics. It's basically, you know, money in, money out. And there is just this, where's all the money going? I'm sort of slightly starting here because I believe in just simple, you know, I'm not an accountant and I've got no interest in doing that, but there's that simple thing. Okay, guys, you had in the share issue, we're talking, you know, 20, 30 million in the bank. Now, you've got your costs of maintaining Ibrox and everything, but realistically, compared to what you used to have, you have very little player wages compared to, you know, back in the day sort of thing. Now, you're getting a bit less money, but you're going to be getting a lot of the same money for, you know, shirt sales and a lot of the same money for sponsorship, really, because it will be you're potentially doing sort of, look, if you look after us now, we'll look after you. Where's all the money gone? That's math, probably, you know, and it's not actually dancing in their grave, and it's just saying, guys, where's it gone? Because there's no way you should have went through that sort of money. See if they'd went out and just, I'll be honest, went mental and they went, right, we're doing a fundraising, our cash raising exercise, and guess what? Here we go. We are going to go out and sign, like they were doing, you know, your equivalent of your Gascoins and your Loudrops and stuff. Then you can go, okay, well, you know what? They had a red hot crack at it and it went horribly wrong. But they can't have that big a wage bill, realistically now. I think the issue they've got at the moment is when they're saying to boys, do you want to take a pay cut? These guys are on the best money probably they're ever going to get, or they're near the end of their career. Why would you bother? You're sitting saying, look, I'm going to get this much money for 4 years or 3 years sort of thing. I'm not taking a pay cut. Why would I? It's not, you know, it's not that.
Absolutely.
I can certainly see it happening. And you know, stuff like we're having to take, asking players to take pay cuts, Ali saying he's going to take a pay cut type thing. To me, there just seems to be this simple, where's all the money gone? You know, as a business, getting with all the assets, picking it up for 8 mil is an absolute bargain. I think is an absolute bargain. And would, you know, but nobody's doing it. So obviously when they're looking at the books, there must be something there that's putting people off. And again, as I said before, I'm not an accountant. I've got no real interest in that. But you know, from a basic fundamental point of view, like if you took it and you just bought Rangers for 8 mil with, you know, it's been liquidated, there's no running debts, you own Ibrox, you even just own the brand. If you didn't kick a ball again, you will still sell Rangers tops for the next 30 or 40 years, just as, some people still buy Triumph, you know, motorbike T-shirts or whatever, so you'll still sell that brand. What are you... How come people aren't ripping their arm off to buy it? And again, I don't know what, and maybe I'm just being too simplistic about this, but do you know where I'm coming from in there, boys? Like, where is the money? And look,
I have to say, man, that was very succinctly put. Yeah, that 30 second answer on a rant for 2.5 minutes. Bloody hell, man! Forget about that. Let's just keep it, you know, keep it quick. Liam, do you have a quick response?
Well, Liam, can you keep it quick, mate? I need to go soon.
I'll say absolutely yes. Admin 2 is going to happen, and I'll tell you why.
Ooh.
I was reading last week that I don't know if you guys follow Phil McGillivan's blog.
Yes.
But I mean, I was reading that, and I've verified it with a few other people as well. Rangers last week or the week before approached a company called Bibby Factors to try and get some liquidity, right? To get some extra money, right?
Did Diddy Factors, or
it's a company called Bibby Factors. They're based in Edinburgh Factors, right now. Through previous business things I've done, I've encountered that company. I know how they operate, right? And basically, they are the they're the business equivalent of Shopacheck, right? You know, Provi, right? If they if you can't get ticked for them, then something is seriously, seriously wrong, because they'll give tick to anybody. You know, so the fact that they knock back Rangers tells me the writing's on the wall. It's going to be a matter of days until they get into admin again.
No, okay. It's all good. That's all good. I did hear, and I think it was Phil McGillivan that was saying it on his blog as well, that if we do the sums, the money's due to run out in round about April time. So it's maybe not in the next few days, but round about then, if they don't rein themselves in, or there's something drastic happens in terms of redundancies or wage cuts, it's round about April time this year.
But well, remember that
April
estimate
Fool's
was given,
Day, maybe. Who knows?
That estimate was given last year, and they've already said that it's worse than that. You know, it's already been revealed that that was based on figures. I think that was based on estimated. I don't know. Just say, for example, that was based on a 1 million loss. It's now proven to be like a 7 million loss. You know, the figures, the actual figures, are a lot worse than that Stockbridge forecast when he said it's going to be, we're going to run out of money in April.
Well, even better. So, if there's another forum, Scottish Football Monitors, and again, it can get really in depth, so I tend to sort of glance over stuff, but they'd made some estimate that VAT was actually already overdue.
Yep, has been for about 6 weeks.
So yeah, so that's the, and if it's true and they're even close to it, then yeah, it's the Grim Reaper's knocking on the door again. Now, this is my take on it. I reckon that they will go into admin again. I do not think they will be liquidated, though. I reckon this is either, as Martin said, either someone's waiting to pick them up on the cheap. But the other thing I was looking at, again, same as Martin, I'm no accountant, and I've got no interest in the whole world of finance. It kind of bores me. But I just, the way I look at it is, even if they went into administration, okay, they're insolvent at the moment, because obviously their outgoings are greater than their incoming sort of funds, whatever. Mm-hmm. Who are they going to owe money back to? I mean, obviously, you'd think, you know, HMRC are going to be keeping a very, very close eye on them. There's no way that they'd be get off a hook again. But they don't owe any of the big banks and like any major money, because the banks won't loan them anything. So it's going to be your flipping, you know, face painter and stuff like that again. It's going to be those sort of guys that they owe money to. And what are they going to do? Are they going to challenge them? Anyway, that's kind of my take on it. I think they'll go into administration again, but I cannot see liquidation happening a second time. That's just my take on it. Okay. I don't think they owe anyone powerful enough money that would justify it. But
yeah, but they'll be able to. It's as if they've come up with this kind of calculated by sheer quirk of fate or mismanagement again, but they're far enough ahead in their lowly division that they'll take their 15-point reduction. I don't know, is there an additional reduction? Because some might see it as the second time it's happened, but of course others would see it, like ourselves, as it's the first time it's happened to this new club. So they'll get a 15-point reduction, they'll still win the league, and they'll still progress as they probably would have done, except, as you said, if they do go into administration, they'll probably wipe off any debts that they've got just now. They might be able to strike up a CVA this time round with the people they owe money to, and they'll get off quite lightly, actually, I think, at that stage. But again, knowing the way that they are and the way they think, the way they do their business, it wouldn't surprise me if they have a third attempt and go down a similar pathway, because I don't think they'll find it as easy. When they even get into the Scottish Championship, if that's what the second tier of Scottish football is called nowadays.
Anyway, boys, I think we're now 30 minutes into the show, and Billy Sweeney and Higgins in the chat room are saying, never mind Sevco. And Billy's actually said, at least it's not about Aberdeen yet.
Well,
we did start with the theme song. We started our little normal little tune at the start of the show, and then we followed up with the bold Kaiser Chiefs with everything is average nowadays. So I guess the thought behind that was, after Saturday's result, I guess we should go and talk about it is, well, what do we have to look forward to? There's not really much going to be happening, you know what I mean? So I guess we should dive in and talk about the Aberdeen game. So I guess Kev would normally ask who managed to catch the game. Kevin?
I did catch the game, Patrick, yes. I did watch it, and after 5 minutes, everything was going according to plan. We get a goal up, but then we just seemed to fall away. Aberdeen came into the game, and in my opinion, controlled the majority of the first half thereafter. I think we get into the second half. At that stage, you're looking for a bit of a reaction, but it just never seemed to come. As far as I was concerned, there was a bit of huffing and puffing. I personally think we underestimated them, even though they have been doing well, Aberdeen, in the lead up to that game, and they sounded confident going into the game. I still think we underestimated them a little bit. But I think there's a bit of an overreaction as well. The whole thing about the everything's average nowadays, or is there nothing to look forward to the rest of the season? I'll be brutally honest, guys, as well. Some of the cup competitions, they're all run of the mill to me now. Anyway, the domestic cup competitions, they don't excite me any more than just the league excites me. Anyway, so whether we go on and we get to the final of the Scottish Cup, it's good if we can do it. But I'm that bothered about it. I was quite annoyed last week, but when I took the old reality check, and again, we can't win every single game we play, they were up for it, we weren't as up for it, and as I said, I think we underestimated them. We got beaten, funnily enough it was in the cup, and we might talk about that in a second, about this possible cup hoodoo. But no, I think there's a bit of a reality check needed. We play Aberdeen again in the league at Pittodrie in a week or two, and I wouldn't be surprised if we go up there and beat them. But as far as what we've got to look forward to, we've got another championship to look forward to, I hope. Hopefully we can go unbeaten as well in the league, and look forward to a few more clean sheets in the league as well. I think that's what we can look forward to.
Is that enough though, Kev? Is that enough for you as a Celtic fan?
Well, you can only do what's in front of you, Pat. And so for me, I'd say yes, it is. You can only beat what's in front of you in whatever competition you're playing in. The reality is we're out of the two domestic cup competitions, which, as I said earlier on, they don't really excite me much anyway. The league is the big one, because by winning that, it gives you a shot at the Champions League, which, let's face it, that's the one we're all interested in. We want to do as well as we can in it.
But so, take a step back, right? So let's look at, you're saying like it's not any more exciting right now. You're El Presidente in an overseas Celtic supporters club, right? Now, take it, and Martin will probably back me up here. One of the more exciting and interesting and fun times you actually have in an overseas supporters club is Scottish Cup final day.
Yeah,
when you're in the Scottish Cup final, it's just a major buzz. Everyone's getting together. Everyone's fired up for it. You know, singing goes on. Everyone's knocking back a few beers, and it's just a great, great occasion to be watching Celtic playing League Cup finals. I can live without it, because we have pretty much, well, for a generation or two in the League Cup. But in terms of Scottish Cup final, last game of the year and all that sort of stuff, I think it's a big loss. And again, I'm probably speaking for every supporters club, even in Scotland and in Ireland and stuff as well. But if you can't be there, that is one of the biggest nights of the year for especially a supporters club on the other side of the world. When you've got a game that's going to be on just, I don't know, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, and everyone's together and everyone's fired up for that day. It doesn't matter who you're playing, if it's Aberdeen, Hibs, Kilmarnock, whoever. It's a massive, massive event and a big occasion for people like us. So to say that it doesn't excite you, I think you're missing a big opportunity for your own CSC on that.
No, it's a big opportunity loss. Let's not forget we won the Scottish Cup there last season, and we had our night, and it was a great little night as well. And it was a fantastic night, but we've had some other great nights on league games. There's a lot of variables in that. It depends on how many members turn up to a game, what the mood's like, has people had a bit of a drink in them or whatever it can be. We've had good nights watching Celtic play. I can't remember what our first game was that we watched in the club, but it was just a bog of the run of the mill league game. That was as good a night as we'd had in that club than the cup final was. I know what you're saying, and of course, I'd be foolish to say would I rather give up playing in the Scottish Cup final. Of course, I'd love to be there, but the reality is we're not. But does it upset me that much? It doesn't. It really doesn't, because the only competition that matters to me, the domestic competition, is the Championship, and we're going to win that anyway. Because that's the tournament that gives us the prize at the end of the day. For me, the Scottish Cup and the romance of the Scottish Cup died long, long ago. It's never really bothered me too much. When you're in it, it's great, and if you get the final and you win it, it's fantastic. But if you get knocked out, I don't cry about it too much.
Kev, I was going to say, I remember Eddie Pearson making a comment, and I think it was, it's like getting the Scottish Cup final is a bit like getting sort of invited to I think it's your auntie's wedding or a boy fae works wedding that you sort of know. If it's all, you get invited and you get there, it's all right. But if you're not that bothered. I actually totally agree with Pat what you're saying from a supporters club point of view. But from a big picture point of view, do we really care if we get there? We want to win the league. We want to get into the Champions League. That to me is that's the bigger nights. Totally agree, Pat. Sensational night, Scottish Cup night. The place is jumping. We're all up for it. But I think that's from probably 12,000 miles away rather than in Scotland.
All right, let me paint this scenario for you then. This very simple scenario. Sevco get to the final. It's at Parkhead.
All right.
Yeah. And they play Inverness. Would you rather have been in the Scottish Cup final playing against them? Although some people do want to play them, some people don't. But would you rather be in that scenario where they've got a chance of winning it and you can't do anything about it?
I suppose I'll come back to you saying we want to win every competition we're in. But if you've got a choice between winning the league and winning the Scottish Cup, I think you take a league every day. We want to win everything, but there's different degrees. Like the League Cup final is down in my. It's the if you win it, it's nice and it's all right. We've won a trophy, and don't get me wrong, there's times when we've needed to win that. Again, Scottish Cup. If we go back to '95, we were all very happy that day. But it's different degrees, sort of thing. But of course, we want to win everything.
Don't know. I think it's.
I think Pat, you've had too many Scottish Cup final. Nice to remember, and you've got it up there on a pedestal.
Or maybe he doesn't remember two of them. Maybe he's been too drunk, and that's what he's wanting to get back to.
I'd love to have a shandy or two at Scottish Cup final, and I will definitely miss it. So I guess I've not so much fear, but it would make it very, very, very uneasy on me if Sevco get to the final, and especially at Parkhead. Because if we were there, we've got a chance of doing something about it. But the fact we're out of the competition means we can't do anything about it. We have to sit back and watch. Now,
but don't forget, they've still to get to the final, mate. And I don't think that's a foregone conclusion.
And it's not. I'm just saying it was all hypothetical. But again, it's just my take on it. So we've been
right,
joined by another caller.
I'm going to ask you this then. It's related. Related to that comment, would you rather us not be in the final, so couldn't do anything about it, and they win it, than us be in the final and they beat us and win it?
Oh, Jesus.
For God's sake.
Is it an extra time, Martin? Be more specific about it. I don't know. I'd rather our fate was in our own hands, put it that way.
All right.
And if it was actually beating them on our own pitch, then I would take that risk.
That is like asking a guy, would you prefer syphilis or gonorrhea? You know what I mean?
Everybody knows it's syphilis. That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous, Liam. We all know that.
For God's sake.
Well, listen, guys, as Pat said, we've been joined by another caller. It's Corpac Boy. Hello there, Corpac Boy. How are you?
How you doing, fellas? You all right?
Very good, mate. Very good. Are you phoning in with a point about Sevco or Pat's worry that they're going to get to the Scottish Cup final at our patch? They'll tear up. We know they'll tear up the seats anyway. That's a foregone conclusion. But have you got any thoughts on the Scottish Cup and the merits of it?
I was phoning in on behalf of Carlsberg UK.
Oh!
Just to say that you've no chance of ever getting any sponsorship deals with us.
Is that because of the Heineken link?
Aye. No. No. To be fair, I've been very disappointed with the club's performance in the cup this year.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I agree that I agree with you in some ways that, you know, like the league is the be all and end all, but it was always going to be a given that we were going to win the league this year.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that a good wee run in the cups, I think the team should have been more up for it than they were. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. The Aberdeen game, that was fucking disappointing.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I'm saying? Like,
it was. Do you think we underestimated them though, or do you think we were actually up for it and they just were the better team on the day?
I only watch the games on. I listen to the games on Celtic TV, so you know I hear them on just an audio feed,
yeah.
And then listen to them or watch them back then and later on, and. Watching that game on the Celtic TV, I just don't think that we got the set out right in the midfield.
Mm-hmm.
I think that the set out was wrong. You know, with Samaras and with Bruni, your new fella,
Johansson.
Johansson, and Forrest on the right. They were overrun.
Mm-hmm.
And
don't you think that's a sad reflection, though? That, like, no disrespect to them, but I loved Barry Robson when he played for Celtic. Again, I love that sort of midfielder. And, you know, great, great player and stuff. But
I guess you could say,
you know, journeyman, Willow Flood, you know, came to us, did nothing, went back to Dundee United, did kind of all right. But our midfield's been overrun by... You know, Barry Robson and Willow Flood, really?
I agree 100% Willow Flood. But Barry Robson, I think, is a great player. You know, I think he is a good player. I can see how he could dominate our midfield. But Willow Flood, I mean, you know, Jesus Christ.
Well, not just him, but they're like, I can see his face, can't think of his name. The younger guy, sort of dark hair, quite tall. He was sort of doing breakaway after breakaway. I mean, he was basically just getting the ball and running at us. And we had nothing. We had no pace. We had no one. You know, Johansson certainly wasn't tracking back. And Bruni was, he was getting bullied by a young lad.
Yeah.
It was just, the writing was on the wall fairly early. I don't think there'd be one Celtic fan that looked at that and saw the team sheet and went, yep, that's fine. You know, I'm happy with that. I would probably say 90% of people would have went, Samaras, really? And even Stoke to a certain extent.
But I don't think it's wrong for a fan to criticise a manager. You know, I'm not saying that Lennon is not a good manager. I think he is. You know, and the things he's had to endure, you know, have been horrible.
Yeah.
And but I do think that, you know, like, criticism is criticism. You know what I mean? You can take it, you can give it, and sometimes you can accept it. And I think that it was wrong. He was wrong there in setting out the team in that game, and he the changes he made were not positive, shall we say?
Or they certainly didn't make much of a difference.
Aye, that's what I'm trying to get at. Aye.
I mean, Pat, you're saying the writing was on the wall early on, but after 10 minutes, we were 1-0 up, and it was like any other game. I don't think at that point in time anybody foresaw what was going to happen until Aberdeen started getting into the game. And again,
I reckon they get into the game pretty much shortly after we scored. I don't think it took them long actually to take control of the midfield. That's what I'm saying by the writing was on the wall. It was great we got the goal, but I didn't feel at any stage, even shortly after that, that you know we were going to run away with it and it was going to be a 4-5-0 game. I don't know about you guys, but
I think you're right, Pat. No, I agree with you.
You know when you just you see a game, you like you score in the first 5 minutes and you go, this is going to be a walkover. I didn't see anything that inspired me to say it was going to be.
Maybe, well, that's certainly not the way I'm coming across, or trying to put my point across, but I'm not saying it was going to be a walkover, but we were 1-0 up. We haven't conceded a goal for God knows how long in any game. I saw no reason why, albeit Aberdeen had a bit of the ball, I certainly didn't expect them to score two goals past us. I didn't think it was going to be a whitewash or anything like that, but when we were 1-0 up, I thought, right, here we go, we've got our noses in front again. It might be another, you know, there's games we've won, we've dominated in games we've won 1-0. I saw no reason why that might have been quite a evenly balanced game, but we still would have ran out 1-0 winners potentially. The other thing for me was, albeit we had dropped out of the game, I don't think we were certainly getting hammered, but, you know, Aberdeen were given as good as they were getting. They were probably slightly their noses in front, if you like, in terms of possession, the control in the game. But as soon as it got to half-time, I remember thinking myself, right, Lenny will get them in at half-time. He'll go through them like a dose of the salts and we'll see a different team in the second half. The most disappointing thing for me is we didn't see a different team in the second half. It was more of the same. And that was the disappointing thing for me. I don't think Aberdeen were head and shoulders better than us or anything like that. I'll go back to it. I think we underestimated them getting into that game. They were talking themselves up and they delivered on what they were saying about themselves, really. They were confident getting into that game and they probably deserved it. They probably deserved to edge it on the day. But do I think they're a better team than us? Nope. Do I think we'll go up to Pittodrie in a couple of weeks' time and beat them? Probably.
Peter Pollitt was the guy I was thinking of. Young guy.
Yeah, yeah.
Boys, I'm going to need to head. I've got an early start in the morning, so I'll disappear now and leave you boys to it, all right?
Good on you, Martin. Good luck tomorrow, mate. Happy admin day.
Thanks, all boys. Take care.
Thanks, Martin. See you later.
See you, mate. Take care.
Boys, can I just say a great, you know, kudos to all you boys away out there. You know, thousands of miles away from us here in the UK, and you know, and your support for the team, it's just incredible. You know, when you boys get up at God knows what hour in the morning or the middle of the night, and it just shows what a fantastic support we've got. You know, great kudos to you all, Martin. All the best, man. Hail, hail.
He's gone.
Good on you, poor back boy.
I don't think he heard
anything. That's how desperate he is. He didn't even wait for the end of your eulogy there.
He was actually talking before the thing even started. Oh, that's it. I'm going to my bed. No, I've had enough. No, I'm not even going to talk. I'm not going to stay for half an hour. And that was about an hour ago. How long have we gone for?
He stayed longer than he said he would anyway. Fair play to him. But listen, Corpac boy, listen, hang about if you wish. If you're not in a rush to get off.
No, I'm all right. More than welcome. I am working from home today, so I'm just sitting with a laptop on my knees here, and I'm checking my emails and you know.
Can't beat a bit of WFH. You can't beat a bit of WFH. It's what it's all.
You're basically skiving. That's brilliant. So, because fellas in there, where are you? Where are you calling in from? You know, you were on Homeboys the other night
I'm
as well.
I'm in Ellesmere Port in the northwest of England.
Yeah.
It's between sort of Chester and Liverpool.
Mm-hmm.
I know, yeah.
My local team are Tranmere Rovers.
Very good. So, do you listen into the show a bit, Corpac boy?
I know. I listen to most of the HailHail Media shows.
I think he actually tried to call in a couple of the last show, Kevin, but we were having. I was having such a shit time.
It was right to the death, wasn't it? Aye.
Yeah, I was. I just wanted the thing to end. I was getting out of there, so So Kev, don't get caught.
Fair play to you boys. Like, it's just amazing, all you fellas. You know, you got the boys in the USA. You're half a world away.
Beyond the waves.
Beyond the waves, and it's just you think, fuck's sake, you know what I mean? You've got boys all over the world here, like, you know.
Well, you got
it's incredible.
You got Prefontaine and Carl in Melbourne as well. They do the Rebel podcasts. So yeah, they're basically everywhere.
Yeah, they're a bit sweary though, aren't they?
Well, I'll tell them that next time I see them. Yeah, so and the other thing is they get the grandmother and the mother on that show as well. So the screen. Bloody hell.
I know.
Potty mouse. Potty mouse. Well, see, the thing is, like, again, we'll come, we do the mentions at the end of it. Like, we've got a Celtic supporters convention. Not a convention, that's the wrong way to put it. A small gathering up in the Gold Coast. I was chatting to head honcho today, Chris McMonagle, and, like, the numbers are just, slowly increasing. So we're well over the 100 people mark, and that's excluding incredible. All the guys from Brisbane that haven't even sort of booked in yet. So we're probably going to be more like 120, 130 guys coming in from every corner of Australia to go to this thing. It's just, it's amazing the actual draw that even, you know, people say we're playing a crappy little league, but we've still got a big draw wherever we are in the world, so don't ever underestimate that.
I think sometimes, you know, it's not just about the league, it's the ethos, you know what I mean?
Yes.
When I brought my lads, and they're born in England, and they've been brought up now as Celtic fans, and I take them to games, and they buy into it. You know, the whole thing, this, I'm not saying more than a club, that's a bit, but, you know, this living wage thing, that pisses me off.
Well, you know, let's not talk, we've got a little bit of a scoop on that a bit later. I guess it's along those lines. So you jumped the gun there a little bit, Mr. Korpak. So just hold, you know, hold, I mean, your horses.
No, that Liam's annoyed got, me.
Liam's, you know, got a bit of a say, when... Liam's got a bit of a scoop later on. So just hold on that one. In fact, what Liam's going to talk about is probably going to piss you off even more. So just pull back the reins, and we'll let's talk about football. So
well, guys, before we go off the subject of the Aberdeen game, then we'll move on. There was a point, and Liam, you'd brought it up earlier on in the week, and it's worth discussing actually, because at that game, the Aberdeen fans were quite vocal during the game, as you can imagine. But they've definitely, since that little the incident with Lenny at Tynecastle. In that cup game, and he took a fair bit of abuse. All of a sudden, they deem Neil Lennon's the most evil man in Scottish football again, for reasons unbeknown to me. But anyway, they were chanting during the game, "You're in the wrong effing country." Now, I think the point, Liam, that you'd made during the week as well was that the inconsistency of this offensive behaviour at Football Act that's there, when you'll get some of our fans will be shouting maybe this, that or the other, you'll get the Aberdeen fans categorically, you could say, it sends the same kind of message as the, you know, it's time to go home, all that kind of stuff, you're in the wrong effing country. Now, are there double standards in Scottish football? Has anybody heard about anything that happened to the Aberdeen fans, given that they were singing those songs? Or, you know, is it one rule for us and another rule for the rest of Scottish football? You made the point, I guess, Liam. What's your own thoughts on it?
Well, the thing is, it's not just Aberdeen fans. I mean, there was a case a few weeks ago. Now, the guy ended up I think it was like he was found guilty, but he was admonished, so he didn't actually get a criminal record out yet. But there was a Partick Thistle fan got done, and this is just stupid, right? Now, one of my good mates back home is a Partick Thistle fan, so I've been to a few Partick Thistle games during the years with him, and they've got this chant which I think is actually quite funny, right? And it's basically like, "We hate the boys in green, we hate the boys in blue," but the punchline is like, "Fuck your Pope and fuck your Queen."
Yeah, I know this. I know the song.
It's satirical, right? To me, that is satire.
Yeah.
It's lampooning us and the Huns, right? Yeah. And, you know, I think it's quite funny, actually. And the Aberdeen fans, all right, it's more expensive, but I think it's the same thing. However, what I would say is, if Celtic fans are going to get done for singing rebel songs, then how come we can sing a song about Irish republicanism and that's deemed offensive, yet they can say we're in the wrong effing country, which, I mean, that is a racist comment, even if it is intended as a joke.
Yeah.
It's a racist comment. And again, Thistle fans, they sing F the Pope and F the Queen, and they don't get done. You know, consistency. This whole law is stupid, right? You shouldn't lock
people up for singing
this
song. That's the double standard, isn't it?
Aye,
you're right.
Basically.
That's a double standard.
Aye, exactly.
Mm-hmm. I've got to say, seriously, if things are going to get drawn up because of what the Aberdeen fans sung, then I think we're at the end of it. I just think it's an overreaction. I think it's just Aberdeen fans trying to wind Celtic fans up, and
they
succeeded. I agree with that.
They absolutely succeeded. So,
but Pat, wait a minute, right now, right, to take that at face value, why wasn't it so funny in the ex-Rangers fans or the Seth Conians when they were singing "It's Time to Go Home" and all the rest of it? Were they not just having a laugh?
See, honest truth, Kev, I don't really care what they sing, and I have totally been honest with you. They can sing what they want. If they think that's going to offend me, like, all right, I'll disagree with it and I'll get angry if I'm sitting watching the games. But seeing the big scheme of things, they can sing what they want.
Is that not the point we're trying to make here, though? Because there's now a law in football that if you get caught saying something offensive or singing something offensive, it's a criminal act. Now, that is offensive. It was proven as offensive. It was raised, and it wasn't picked up by the Scottish media. It took the Irish Parliament to actually make a complaint to the Scottish Football Association or the Scottish Football League or the SPL, whatever body it was. And it's only then that they actually acted on it.
Sorry to butt in.
On you go, Corby.
Is it not the point that it's just what's deemed by the policeman that's what's offensive? Do you know what I mean? If one policeman stand there and he thinks what you're saying is offensive, then he lifts you. And, you know, on another day, another policeman stand there next year, hears somebody saying exactly the same words, doesn't think it's offensive, he doesn't lift you. You know, it's what is deemed as offensive.
Yeah.
Do you know?
And I think they do get given guidelines as to, you know, here's your list of stuff that if you hear it at all, this is the stuff that should be, you know, you pull guys up for. I think that they must have something along those lines. I don't think it would be quite as loose as, you know, there's 100 polis. You could get 100 different opinions as to what's offensive or not. There's got to be some kind of boundaries or guidelines given, I'm sure. But, Pat, I'm surprised that you're saying, you know, that what Aberdeen... When I read that was tantamount to the famine's over, it's time to go home. That kind of thing. It is offensive and it is double standards. I guess that... Where it pisses me off is that, as Corpach said earlier on and Liam said earlier on, our guys will sing songs. These are like Irish folk songs. People will call them sectarian songs. They're not sectarian songs. They're Irish rebel songs. Flower of Scotland is a Scottish rebel song. You can sing these songs at Hampden Park and, you know, it's all about passion and all the rest of it. But you'll get Celtic fans who... There's a substantial number of us have got Irish roots. But yeah, if you sing that at a Celtic game, all of a sudden the whole of Scotland's against you. To me, it's definitely double standards. And to say that Aberdeen fans were just having a laugh, rightly or wrongly, it's wrong. If it wasn't for this Offensive Behaviour Act, fair enough, you just say, okay, they're doing it to wind us up. But there's a law in the country now, and if nobody has been pulled up or questioned about that, to me it's complete and utter double standards.
But you see, that's my point, right? My point is that I don't think anybody should be jailed singing a song, right? I mean, at the end of the day, right, you've got all these bloody EDL, BNP, all these Nazi fuckers who can walk down the street and say whatever they want, right?
Mm-hmm.
And yet, aye, we can't sing a song in a football stadium. What the hell's that all about?
Mm-hmm.
You know, whenever you see, like, that bastard Nick Griffin was on Question Time last year, mm-hmm, and everyone's like, oh, freedom of speech, he's entitled to his opinion if you don't agree with it. So, mm-hmm, well, I'm entitled to be an Irish Republican. If you don't agree with that, to hell with you. Do you know what I mean?
You're spot on, Liam. And I think that's the point I'm trying to get to as well. It's because of this Offensive Behaviour Act is the thing that's got me. I mean, that stuff used to happen at games before, and of course fans come to other grounds to try to goad you and get a reaction. That's fine, I understand that. The difference is that our fans seem to be getting treated differently to other fans that use similar kind of sentiments, similar kind of behaviours. It's the double standards that pisses me off about the whole thing.
Aye.
On that point, boys, do you know how the Roll of Honour song by is getting on in that iTunes chart? I know
the Irish Brigade.
Aye, that's the one I'm on about. I've downloaded it a couple of times, but
well done.
I've held off now because I was thinking that do we need to wait until maybe nearer when the chart gets, you know, whatever it is, latest update, whatever it is, you know, published, and give it a big, you know, hit then, you know what I mean, and start downloading it again.
Well, the last I'd read, it was, I think they released some sort of provisional chart. I think it was Jeanette Finlay, I think, tweeted it out of Celtic Trust, something like that. And it was number 24 in the charts.
I think it got to something like number 15, and then it had dropped back to, you know, as you say, way up in the 20s and that.
Yep. Well, I guess that's, I mean, I'm not really sure we're going to sort of have a chat about that, but obviously Celtic Trust have put out, you know, a big campaign for this. I guess it's not so much them, it's the Fans Against Criminalisation. So they sort of obviously try to promote this whole thing about, you know, try to raise awareness of this, you know, Offensive Behaviour Football Act. So they obviously released
statements.
I can
see it, and you know, if a song's at number, you know, 10 mm-hmm. in the popular music charts, how can you be arrested for singing it? And I can see the whole point in it, you know.
I can. I'll be honest, and we spoke about this before the show started. I feel a little bit uneasy with Roll of Honour, the whole thing. I don't know why. I can't quite put my finger on it. I feel really uneasy about it. And I was really, I don't know if you guys sort of follow stuff on News Now, but there was something came up today about some Rangers statement about Celtic's Roll of Dishonour and stuff like that. And I was waiting for something like to come up. It was just, I don't know. I said, I can't quite put my finger on it. I just don't know why I feel uneasy about it. But this whole Fans Against Criminalisation stuff, they have pretty much knocked the nail on the head. This is now not Fans Against Criminalisation. This is Celtic fans now against criminalisation. Because if you think you're going to get support of Partick Thistle fans and St Mirren supporters and Motherwell supporters by releasing a rebel song, which, it, let's face it, is a rebel song,
you're not going to ever get
their support.
I can see what you're saying, that you know, you're not going to get fans of other clubs backing this. But I think the point was made earlier on, it just seems to be Celtic fans that seem to be getting targeted with this legislation. You know, we're not seeing Aberdeen fans lifted. We're not seeing Partick Thistle fans lifted. So, you know, what else can we do?
I don't know. I feel a little bit uneasy about it. I know that Kevin and Liam probably feel a little bit.
I know you're saying in that Roll of Honour is not going to come across, you know, Pan Scotia. You know what I'm saying? It isn't going to attract Aberdeen fans, Dundee United fans, Partick Thistle fans, you know, Cayley Thistle fans,
mm-hmm.
they're going to want nothing to do with it. But I still think that it stands that it seems to be Celtic fans that are getting lifted more than, you know, Aberdeen fans, Partick Thistle fans, Dundee United fans. So what we've got to stand up for our own.
I think The Roll of Honor is a song that the Green Brigade sang quite a lot of, and it drew attention to them when things were contentious with the club. So, rightly or wrongly, it's become a bit of an anthem. So I think when there was a song chosen to represent the fans against criminalisation, I think it was a fairly reasonable choice or a predictable choice that they went for Roll of Honor. So, I mean, my own views on the song itself, it's certainly not a sectarian song. It should not be seen as an offensive song because, as the old saying goes...
Is it that or the boys of the old brigade? You know what we're going to choose, you know?
Well, again, Corpac, the way I see the Roll of Honor, it was...
By the way, sorry, should I just say, it's Andy, by the way.
Right, okay. If you want to go,
he's outed himself now, Kev. He's outed himself.
I've outed myself.
He has outed himself. Shh, don't say your second name.
No. Shh.
No.
What
I think.
Mean? Aye.
In terms of the Roll of Honor, I mean, at that time of the hunger strikes,
aye,
you were firmly on one side or the other. Now.
Oh, I remember
Maggie Thatcher, who we've talked about on this show before as well, was a bit of a tyrant. And as the old saying goes as well...
A bit of a tyrant.
Sit in the fence, why don't you?
As the old saying goes, one man's freedom fighter is another man's terrorist, or one man's terrorist is another man's freedom fighter. Now, whatever way you think about what happened in 1981... That's a ballad about what happened. In no way, shape, or form is that a sectarian song.
No,
it's a political song, I'll grant you that, but it's certainly not sectarian. So anybody that takes offence to that, and if they actually truly listen to the words, there is absolutely nothing offensive in that song whatsoever, other than you agreed or you disagreed with what the subject matter was about. So... for Celtic fans to be castigated for singing that song because some people take offence to it, I honestly cannot get my head around that. I don't know how you can compare a song like Roll of Honour to either Up to Our Knees in Fenian Blood, Oh No, Pope of Rome, and other such songs that we hear from time to time from the other mob. It's, to me, they're just... You can't compare them. You just cannot compare them.
Even if you say that the simple songs we sing with you know, like, what do you call them? Add-ons.
Yeah.
You know, when boys stick in up the rah or, you know, whatever. Mm. No, I agree with you 100% there. You know, Roll of Honour is no sectarian connotation. What's the worst words used in air? England, you're a monster?
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, pretty much. But anyway, it's one of those ones. I mean, I hear what you're saying, Pat, and I respect your views on it, mate, as well. I would encourage anybody that hasn't actually downloaded it from iTunes to do so of your own free will.
Aye.
But I don't think there's any harm in it at all. It's trying to make...
No, it's 79 pence.
Exactly. It's... It's one of those things, guys. It can divide people's opinions as well. But I'm all for people having their own views on these things. But personally speaking, I see absolutely no harm at all in that's in the song "The Roll of Honour" at all. Yeah, I think I've said enough on it.
Yep,
I agree with Pat that it won't. It won't bind all Scottish football fans together, you know. But you know, sometimes you've got to fight your own corner. And I think that's what
and
we're
like,
doing.
Yeah, again, I'm not sort of criticising people. It's just I truly, hand in heart, I just cannot put my finger on it. But when the whole thing sort of came out, there was just something. I don't know what it is. I won't labour it, but the point. But I think it's just something makes me feel a bit uneasy about it. That maybe it's the fact that rather than doing it in stages or doing it a subtle way, they've just literally went for the jugular. Right, let's release a song. What can we do? What's the one that's going to cause the most controversy? We'll pick that one.
Hi,
you know, and that's kind of what it, that's maybe part of what it what it's all about. There's ways and means of doing it, but I think one bit that does get me, maybe this is what I'm kind of getting at, is the whole thing that the Celtic Trust, and I think this isn't, if I'm understanding this correctly, is kind of representative of all the sort of different fan groups. So everybody's basically, you know, all these different fan groups have all basically backed this whole thing. And I just think there's going to be people like me that do, they're just not sure about it. So there's just this perception that every single Celtic fan is, that wants this. And I don't really like kind of being sort of classed that way. Like, I've got my own opinion on things. I don't want them representing me saying, like, this is what every single Celtic fan thinks, when it's not really the case. You know what I mean?
Pat, is what you're trying to say, do you feel that perhaps that it could be seen that they were steamrolling the whole of Scottish football fans and saying, like, you know, like, we've got the right opinion. You know, we know this. Everybody knows this legislation is wrong. You know, no matter what team you support.
No doubt.
But we're telling you this is the way to fight it. And perhaps that, you know, okay, we do have the biggest fan base. So are we saying that we are right, you're, you know, wrong, everyone join in with us, and perhaps, you know, maybe, you know, that I know what you're saying, and that just because you've got more people saying the same thing doesn't necessarily mean it's right.
That's maybe part of it. See, I've got this whole thing about being sort of told about what you... This is another extreme. Like, the reason I won't buy an Apple device is because the Apple organization dictate to you what you want. And that's why I prefer to choose... I'll buy an Android rather than an Apple device for that simple reason.
Maybe what I'm trying to say, just because everyone else is doing it, doesn't it make it right?
Yeah, maybe. What? I don't know. Again, I can't put my finger on it. I do sort of agree with the whole thing about criminalisation. I do agree with the way the trust are pushing this. I thought the FAC, there might have been, you know, I don't know, a bigger representation from other clubs and stuff like that. And I just think that now that puts a nail in it. I can't see how a Motherwell fan can back that anymore.
But is it because the other fans haven't been impacted as much by this bill as Celtic fans have been?
Well, there's more Celtic fans, so there's by law of averages, you know, there's more of us going to be targeted for it. We certainly have more of a voice than, I guess, the smaller clubs. But you read some of the stuff that's happened to Motherwell fans. They've had a horrible time as well, you know, for fairly minor incidents and stuff like that. They've been sort of targeted as well, but. I just think like that. But pretty much we're now fighting our own corner. I don't think we're going to be getting support through that FAC from other clubs. That's just my take on it. But I don't want to labour it. It's just I guess I'm a bit undecided about the whole thing about, you know, is it the right way to do it? Is it the wrong way to do it? I still kind of make up my mind. But we will sort of play out the show with the song at the end of it. So we kind of made a decision.
I think you have to do something, Pat.
I agree. I don't know. Like, don't want to labour it. Maybe I'd love to know,
Pat, if you were in the committee when this was all getting discussed and he says, right, we need to come up with an idea and we're going to have a song to play that's going to, you know, rally everybody to the cause. Have a wee think about it and let us know which song you would have picked, Pat. You don't need to tell us right now, but I think you should think about that and tell us later on.
Put the man on the spot, why don't you?
Spice Girls. Some of the Spice Girls, I don't know.
I was thinking, yeah.
Right, anyway, moving on.
Number one in the charts next week, night. Zigga, zigga. Right, I think, let's keep on the subject of the fans. And this relationship with Celtic, actually, because it has been coming up. We're talking about the Celtic Trust there. So there's a nice little segue, I suppose, into this next little subject matter. There's still an uneasy feeling, guys, between the fans and the club, and this relationship between the fans and the club. And is it breaking down? Is there any hope? Are the Green Brigade going to come back? Is it beyond hope? Is the atmosphere at Celtic Park going to stay like a library for the foreseeable future? there's quite a few elements to this, guys. And again, Liam, I don't know, what's your thoughts on it, mate?
Well, there's a few things. First of all, I think there's a general feel, and it ties in with what we're going to talk about later on as well, but there's a general feeling for people I know that still go to the games that you're treated like cattle.
Mm-hmm.
You're herded in, herded out again, treated like shite the whole time you're there, and you're thinking, why am I paying, you know, 35 quid a game for this? You know, the days of, oh, it's Celtic, so we'll just go, we'll just go, we'll just go, it's not like that anymore. Because deciding to buy a season ticket or deciding to buy a ticket for the game, with the way things are now with the economy, that is a genuine financial decision. It's like, can I afford to do this, and do I want to do this? And a lot of people now are saying, no. Celtic and other clubs as well, to a certain extent, for just far too long, their fans for granted.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just coming back to, it's coming back to bite them on the arse now, because they've just spent far too long just taking the money and giving nothing back.
Mm-hmm. What's your thoughts on it, Andy?
I agree with Liam. I mean, back in the day, like, I mean, you know, when the boys were we used to have a wee supporters club in here in Ellesmere Port. And they had a minibus, and they'd run it, you know, every other week. And I'd take the boys up 3-4 times a season, you know, maybe 5-6 times a season. Mm-hmm. Nowadays, it's, you know, it's once or twice.
Yeah.
And even then, a couple of times I've been lucky to get, you know, like corporate seats or whatever, or seats from, you know, other means, shall we say.
Yeah.
You know, the money is... It is a financial decision as much as some. You know, I appreciate that there are hundreds and hundreds of guys, well, thousands and thousands of guys out there that buy season tickets and go every week. But some of us, obviously, you know, the travel and you know, whatever else is involved. No, you're going to pick and choose.
Exactly.
I know this is a kind of a moot point speaking to you boys out there fucking in Australia. You know? I'm whinging about travelling a couple of hundred mile up the M6, you know, and you're going like, well, yeah, we've got to cross, you know, umpteen thousand miles of the world, you know.
Well, Andy, just confirm for us, how, if you were taking guys up, obviously you wouldn't have a season ticket if you're, you know, taking guys up for half a dozen games a year, but how much would it cost you? Just think of, you know, not so much the petrol and travel and stuff, but actually into the game and... You know, if you had to buy a bite to eat, so what would the entry? What would you go and buy a ticket for?
You're looking at 20 odd quid, aren't you, for a ticket? And then you're looking at, if you're taking a couple of boys, you know, what do you buy? A couple of pints? I don't know, 2-3 quid a pint. Sometimes, you know, if you're in the middle of Glasgow, you know, pies, 2 quid each. You know, these things just mount up, don't they? You know,
they
varies.
And I guess that's my point. Like, when you come out here, and I don't know, Kev, I know you follow AFL as well, but like I go to the games. Did you ever go to the Frio games over?
No, I've not been to one. I've not been to one yet, Pat. But
okay.
I know it's a lot cheaper to go and see those events than
significantly
than
cheaper.
A day out at Celtic Park. That's for sure.
I mean, it's, and I guess it kind of when you again, Liam can sort of confirm what it's like, you know, in terms of Japanese sports and stuff. But when you come here and you see kind of what you get for your money. I mean, it would cost, I don't know, about $20 to get in, you know, for an adult to get in and watch an AFL game. Goes for best part of 2 hours, you know, and it's nice, you know, if you go to like, what's it called, these Etihad Stadium, it's got a roof on it and stuff like that, you know, if it's pissing down rain outside, you got a nice seat, everywhere's got a good view, you know, and it's 20 quid, $20, sorry, so that'd be like, you know, £10 for a game, you know, and that's like, you know, the prime of the competition, and it's, I guess that's when you come here, you kind of realise how expensive it is back home to go and watch a game. I bought a membership. How much did I pay? It's probably $200 or something like that for, I think I get 11 home games. And it was like $200 for a... it was 250, I think, for a reserve seat.
How does that convert?
So, about 100 quid.
Aye, okay.
I mean, don't be wrong, it's only for 11 games. You can buy a 16 game. So basically,
games is not bad, eh?
You know, but we play 16 games. Like every Victorian team would play 16 games in Victoria because Victoria is where kind of AFL kind of started up. But anyway, getting to the point is that you kind of realise how expensive it is back home. Like, if I was back home earning the wages I was before I left, there's no way I'd be able to afford to go to games anymore. There's no way you could, you know, say spend £300-£500 on a season ticket. I just couldn't. Out here, obviously, being a lot cheaper and stuff like that. You know, obviously, my kids don't go to the games when the AFL are in here, but eventually they will. They'll sort of come to games with me, and it's just, you know, the Aussies complain and have a whinge about, you know, the cost of things at football stadiums here, but they have no idea. They have no idea how expensive actually going and watching a game of soccer, as they would call it, in Scotland would be. You know, like in Australia, you can take, I've seen people, you can take your own food into the games and stuff like that. You know, you take plastic bottles and people take picnics. I've actually seen people with picnic baskets at games.
And you can have a drink at the games as well. You can have a drink at the games.
You can have a drink as well.
To be fair, I think they allow you to take food and that into games in the UK. I mind a testimonial at Leeds. I can't remember who it was now.
Gary Kelly.
Was it Gary Kelly? Aye. And yeah. We had a big packet of hobnobs and that. And I was there with the boys and the missus. And I passed the hobnobs along to the youngest or whatever. And it gets passed back and the packet's empty. And I'm looking behind me and all the boys in the row behind are all like munching away, going like that, giving us a big thumbs up. Cheers, fellas, you know.
You can't beat bringing a pack of hobnobs into the game. They're a macaroon bar.
They're a macaroon bars, aye. Now, to be fair, the main constraint with me is petrol and the time. You know, it's the distance and you know. And to be fair, the last game I went to, I had seats in the director's box. It's a convoluted story, but you know, you get in a nice lounge access where, you know, it's a pay bar and you need to pay for the food and that. But the prices weren't that bad. And I wouldn't say they weren't unequal to what you'd pay, you know, in the pubs around Celtic Park. So, you know, I've not been in the new Kerrydale Street Lounge and I've heard some good things about that. So in that respect, I think the club are doing good things.
I mean,
but still, you know, you say that just the price of modern football. I mean, even going to Tranmere's, you know, I can pay £20 to go and watch Tranmere in the English. What's that? That's League One.
Mm.
You know, it's fucking shite.
say what you feel, Andy. Say what you feel.
Ah, yeah.
But I mean, I guess the thing we're chatting about is how this whole detachment, you know, I guess disconnect from the club and the fans is kind of, I guess, happened. And you know, is it too late? Is there anything that can be done to get that back? I mean, there was talk, for example, of, you know, the whole move to Lennoxtown. You know, that again is an extra disconnect because, you know, fans don't see the players. You know, there's a whole thing about, I mean, do supporters clubs still do functions at Parkhead and stuff like they used to do? I don't know, I've got no idea, I'm sort of too far away to know, but, you know, there's all these things about, you know, back in the day when players would actually pretty much be forced to go and, you know, and go to these functions, you know what I mean? So you hear, obviously, great stories about Tommy Burns.
Is that a bygone day, though? You know what I mean? Are players now so much detached? You do see all the players in that. And you see the PR stuff when they're, you know, doing the charity stuff they do. And I'm not denying that Celtic players, without a doubt, certainly do a lot of charity work. You know, that's well publicised. But I know what you're saying about the old, used to see photos of the boys that turning up at the supporters club's functions. Is that just a different world now, though? You know what I mean?
I think, Andy, social media's had a big part to play in that nowadays as well. The players have got to be so careful. A few years ago, there was, I think it was Stevie Pearson and John Hartson were videoed singing Boys of Old Brigade or something like that at a function. And, I mean, there's no... There's no question that that kind of stuff used to go on in bygone days. But I think that's possibly one of the reasons why They need to, players need to watch themselves now, what they get up to. You know, years ago, they used to be sent out a wee part in the arse, go and enjoy yourself. Aye. They'd get a skinful of drink, they'd have a sing song and all the rest of it, and that was it. But nowadays, with everybody with cameras on their phones and things like that, they've got to be careful. They've got to be really careful. So I think that's one of the reasons. Not that I'm saying I agree with the whole thing, but I think that's a symptom of why it is the way it is nowadays in terms of players going out to supporters' functions and things like that.
No, I know what you're saying. I appreciate that, aye.
I mean, see, in terms of, there's no doubt, guys, that for one reason or another, and whether or not it's all connected with the stuff that's been going on, particularly with the Green Brigade, and that kind of unrest between them and the club. We're chatting with one of my good mates over here in Mandurah, and one of the members of the Mandurah CSC, Dennis Doherty. I had a couple of pints with Dennis the other night, and we were just mentioning about, you know, there's no doubt the numbers have dropped in terms of attendances, but had the Green Brigade thing actually happened or not happened, you know, is that the main reason for the drop off in attendances? Now, I don't reckon it is. I just reckon there's a general kind of malaise around just now because we're getting too used to winning games. The league's going to be won at a canter again. And this is where I feel quite strong about it as well, because, and again, this is me just being my normal, I don't know, the type of fan. If I was back home just now, I'd still be going to see every game. I'd still be going to pay my ticket for bloody going to see us get put out of the League Cup in Morton. You know, all this kind of nonsense. I'd be going to every single pre-season game and all this kind of carry on as well, because I was in the fortunate position I could. To me, it's all about just supporting Celtic. You know, it doesn't matter how they're doing, it doesn't matter who they're playing, it's all about going along to Celtic Park to see Celtic playing whoever the hell they happen to be playing that day. Whether there's 30,000 at the game or whether there's 60,000 at the game, it's always just about going to see Celtic for me. Now, there was talk, and I think you were maybe thinking about there's some initiatives as to how we get the crowds back again as well, Liam. You're talking about following the J-League model. What are some of the ideas that they do in the J-League to try to get the attendances up?
Well, there's a few, but before I get into that, I was just going to say that what you just said there, you know, this very romantic idea of you go and see Celtic no matter what. Now, no disrespect to you, but that's the very thing that allows them to get away with all the crap they're getting away with now.
Yeah, and I totally I reckon there's plenty more Celtic fans out there that can relate to that. I was one of those fans, Liam, rightly or wrongly. When I was back in Scotland, I was one of those fans.
I was the same.
I would go along, I would put up with all the shit. You know, all the disagreements. You know, I remember the time when they were talking about boycotting games. That made my stomach feel sick, because I didn't feel, much as I might have agreed with the fact that, you know, it's the right thing to do, I didn't want to not attend a game, makes sense. It honestly made me feel sick to think that Celtic are playing in there and you could potentially be standing outside the ground while the team I love are playing it. It just wasn't for me. I'm one of these blind Celtic fans. And it would take a hell of a lot for me to get, you know, perturbed about stuff, too much stuff like that. And you're right, I totally take your point, and I'm sure there's plenty more like me out there that you're just blind Celtic. And much as it might be the right thing to do, to take action one way or another, for me it was always just going to Celtic Park to see Celtic play.
Right, we'll get on to what we're saying about the J-League, right? There's a few things. First of all, accessibility, right? Now, I don't know how it is, but I've heard all kinds of horror stories, people just trying to get tickets for the game.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there was a guy phoned in Radio Clyde a couple of weeks ago, and he was like, oh, I was caught in traffic, and I showed up 10 minutes late for the game. They're like, you can't buy a ticket. You need to go to the ticket office. Where's the ticket office? Shut 10 minutes ago, you know. Mm-hmm. There's a guy ready to give them money, and they will only take it, right?
This was Japan, for the Aberdeen game?
No, this was a few weeks ago. This was for a league game. But anyway, what they do over here, which is brilliant, the J League have got a tie-up with 7-Eleven, the convenience stores, right? Mm-hmm. For people in Scotland, that's the equivalent of like Spar or your corner shop, right?
Thanks for that.
Sorry. But,
we didn't have Spars in England.
What's your equivalent in England then, Andy? Your Spar equivalent?
Would it be Home Bargain or something like that? Like, I'm not sure.
I don't know. Anyway, they've got a tie-up with these shops, and these shops are everywhere, all over every city in Japan. Mm-hmm. And basically, you get into that shop, and in the window, there's posters up showing your local team's like next five fixtures. So, like, because I live in Osaka, the one next to me, it says, okay, like, Osaka, I've got these next five games. Gamba Osaka, I've got these next five games. Cerezo Osaka, I've got these next games. Kobe, I've got this next load of games. Kyoto, I've got this next load of games. Because they're all places that are within like an hour of Osaka, right? Mm-hmm. And you can walk in there. There's a wee machine that looks a bit like an ATM. And you get in there, and you can just buy your ticket right there. And that's your ticket for the game. And you can choose exactly where you want to sit. You can choose if you want like to be close to the ground or further back. You can choose if you want to be next to the ultras or away from the ultras. Yep. You can choose if you want a heated seat or a regular seat. You know, it's very easy. Mm-hmm. And more so, just when you actually get to the game, for the minute you walk in, it's all wee smiley faces of people that are serving you. It's all very well presented. Because the staff are well paid. You know, right. People who work at stadiums here get paid the same as people who work in Starbucks, you know?
Okay.
And
is this like a kind of, you're talking about like a living wage thing there? You know what I mean?
Aye, basically.
If you're paying people peanuts, they're going to just go like that, slap your coffee on the table. But if they're being respected for what job they're doing,
yeah,
you know what I mean? Then yes, they're going to be better at their job.
But that's the Japanese culture as well, is that Japanese do tend to take pride in anything they do. You know, if you're working at the petrol pump serving petrol, the average Japanese, look, well, I want to be the best damn petrol pump attendant in the world. You know, that is their mentality.
Mm-hmm.
But more to the point, you know, you get in and there's a variety of food on offer. You can get your sandwiches, you can get your hot dogs, hamburgers, you can get your sushi, you can get your noodles.
Mm-hmm.
Anything you want, really, is there. There's about four or five different wheat stalls that sell different stuff. You can go to your seat right away. We're in your seat. There's a wee lassie walks up and down during the game with this big sort of keg strapped to her back, serving beers. I mean, you can literally sit there.
We need one of them at Celtic Park, don't
we? Now, that one would never happen.
You need to be a big lassie.
I mean, Liam, what are the... Well, what kind of size, first of all, to get an appreciation for it? What kind of size stadiums are we talking about in the J League? But also, what kind of attendances are the average attendances for the J League?
Right, well, what you've got to remember is that in Japan, football is very much number two to baseball, right?
Right.
Baseball is the absolute number one. Baseball is where you get 50,000, 60,000 crowds every week, right?
Yeah.
I think the most popular team in the J League right now would be Urawa Red Diamonds, and they're based just outside Tokyo. And they actually have like the Japan National Stadium, the Saitama Stadium. And that's a capacity of like 75,000. I think their average gate's maybe about 30,000.
Mm-hmm.
In Osaka, we've got two teams, and I think their average gate is about 15,000, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Hi.
You know, it's decent
still
crowds.
Not bad. Yeah.
I can see that's better than I thought.
It's on a par with, if you take Celtic and Rangers out of the equation, it's on a par with the SPL, definitely.
Aye.
Yeah, yeah.
And the thing is, as well, it's spread all over Japan because, like, every region has got at least three or four teams, you know? And it's just a really well-organised league. And they've got tie-ups with all the big companies, you know, like, you can get your J League app on your iPhone. You can get you can subscribe to your you can watch results, watch highlights on your iPad or your phone or whatever. You know, it's just all really nicely tied in feel like the moment
other
you go to Baggy...
are available.
I'm sorry. he said, sitting looking at his Android phone. You can actually, you know, for the minute you buy your ticket in 7-Eleven, to the minute you get home for the game on your lovely, comfortable train, it's just, the whole thing is done so professionally, and it's done so, you feel appreciated. Mm. And the other thing is, it's not that dear. The dearest ticket is about 5,000 yen, which is about, I think, about 34 quid.
34 quid?
Oh, no, that's the dearest ticket.
Right, okay.
They start at 1,000 yen, which is, what, £7.50?
Aye.
Right?
No, that's fair enough.
Yeah, aye. And remember, that I'm saying, like, your dearest ticket, that is the equivalent of, like, getting a box seat at Celtic Park. You know, it's that level of hospitality. But, you know, it's just such a different thing. You know, I've been to games with Japanese friends, and I'm like, is it not like this in Scotland? I'm like, oh, no, not at all. Not even close.
But see, Liam, I think that's where it's the bizarre thing, because it's all good hearing about how things happen in the Aussie Football League here, and for the Aussie rules and things like that from Pat. And we've heard about how things operate in the J-League. But the thing that's completely different about ourselves as Celtic fans as well, no matter what league we're playing in, so whether or not it's the SPF, GFSL, or whether it's the English Premiership or whatever it would be, the one unique thing is that we have a bit of a different outlook. We have a bit of a different background. We've got a bit of a different culture. It's not all about going to be entertained. I mean, for Christ's sake, we went through God knows how many years of being anything but entertained. It's all about the team you support and the team you follow. And as Celtic fans, the majority of us know that you don't necessarily become a Celtic fan. You're born a Celtic fan. In whatever way, you know, whether you like it or not. Now, again, that's not the case for 100% of us, of course, but for a huge amount of us, you're born a Celtic fan. And much as, just as you're explaining that there, it's making me think, you know, would I feel any differently if I was back home just now and, you know, you were walking into the stadium and there was somebody there to, you know, hello there, Mr. O'Neill, how are you going, blah, 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 and, oh, here's a wee quite warm pie for you to entertain yourself or something. Now, see if that was the kind of, would I feel any differently about, see, I probably wouldn't, right, because that would then become the norm. The norm back there just now, of course, is you're paying about £5 for a shitty pie or something like that, and it's... I don't know, it's great to hear about how I guess sports teams, whether it's football or whether it's the Aussie rules and things, how they operate, but there's still, for me, there's a completely unique thing about ourselves, and you could say that for other football teams around the globe as well, I suppose. There's, when you compare to things like the A-League in Australia, for example, when you've got some teams that have only been around for a handful of years, you know, they've got these really passionate fans. That I'm thinking about part of the Western Sydney Wanderers, for example, that have only been around a couple of years. Now, you see some of their games live in the telly over here. They've got the Flamengo strip, if you're familiar with those colours of in Brazil, the red and black hoops that they play in. And they're from a European kind of area of Sydney. But, I mean, the passion that these guys have for a club that's only really been formed for a couple of years is quite incredible. But it can't possibly be the same passion that we, the four of us on here, have got about Celtic, for example.
People, obviously being in Victoria, you're the same, Western Australia, there's a lot of like footy, AFL, Aussie Rules fans.
Yeah.
And there is... people, I mean, they love the club. There's no any doubt about it. But in terms of the way that people follow their club, there's nothing kind of like it. It's more of a hobby. if you know what I mean. It's more like just something you do. But don't, that I'm probably tarring everyone with the same brush, but there's some people who genuinely have an absolute love for the club. But I'm talking, if you consider, you know, like for like, it's not really the same. You know, it's more of a, like, I go to the games and, okay, I follow St Kilda, so I love, you know, go and watch them and stuff like that. But if it came to a choice between one or the other, there is no competition.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
I mean, you get you want to win games and stuff like that. It's just like any team that you follow. But there's just, you know, like I go where I meet Brian Kenny from East Kilbride, so we'll sit at St Kilda games and probably end up talking half the game about Celtic. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's as much of a social thing, and I think that's a big thing for people over here. That, you know, you're right, and it, like A-League stuff like that, it's young. It's a really kind of young league, but they just can't have that same level of passion. You know, like Celtic is a way of life, no matter what people say, it is for so many, too many of us. It's a way of life. You know, the first thing you do, you wake up in the morning, check your phone, go on the, you know, what's happened?
Yep.
I'm on Kerrydale Street, I'm on News Now.
Absolutely.
I'm checking Twitter, that's, you know, and it's a routine of every single day you do the same thing. Every single day.
Is that because sad, by the way?
But well, that's what I'm saying. It's a major part of your life. Sitting here, it's now what time? It's 5 to midnight on a Friday night. I could be doing better things, you know, with myself on a Saturday night. But it's just because you want to be...
Well, I know I'm going to go out and get pished.
I think I might have just started doing that, actually. Pure Blonde tonight, Kev. That's what I'm on. So anyway, that's another
story. Well played. Not Heineken.
It looks like Heineken. Pure Blonde's it's a nice limit. It's a low...
Sorry,
a low.
Carlsberg said that they're not touching you. Well, not with all these references to Heineken.
Well, I'm curious now about the Carlsberg link that you've obviously got there now. So, listen, I can be easily persuaded.
Easily swayed.
Free beer, Christ. Don't tempt him, Christ.
We don't ask for much. A wee carton every now and again wouldn't go far wrong.
Exactly. Selfish bastard. Anyway, but I don't know whether we've kind of laboured this sort of point too much. I know we've got stuff that Liam wants to get onto about sort of staff and whatever, but in terms of, you're absolutely right. In terms of what, you know, the other sports, you know, falling over here, I can't really speak for A-League sort of fans, you know, Melbourne Victory, Melbourne Heart, those sort of guys. Can't really speak for them, but you're right. If there's any team that's probably getting a little bit close to it, it's probably Western Sydney Wanderers. But I think a big part of that is that it's a real community thing. You're right, and it's more of a, I guess, an Eastern European, not Eastern Europe, what would it be? I'm trying to think the right term would it be. It's like it's kind of a like an Eastern European kind of culture in the western side of Sydney. And when I say Western Sydney, it's flipping miles from Sydney. It's like a different town city altogether. So they basically, this football club kind of came up, and it's kind of like a, they've got an identity, if you know what I mean. I think that's why they've just kind of really grasped it and ran with it, and it's. It's actually quite inspiring to watch them. If you watch,
it definitely is. But I mean, it's very Green Brigade-esque, you would say,
absolutely,
in terms of their lateral movement and all that kind of stuff as well. But I guess that was the point I was making. These guys, you can see them, and there's no doubt that they bring a huge atmosphere to the games that they play in. But I mean, they're a club that's been formed just for 2 years.
2 years, yeah.
You cannot possibly compare or compete that with a club of our history and all the rest of it, and what it actually means to people day in, day out. And I'm sure there's not a Western Sydney Wanderers podcast happening in Glasgow right now.
No, I think you're probably right there, Kev. But, you know, I think for us, it's just, and again, this is one thing that we were going to raise at a future podcast is, it's whether that the passion, I guess, that we have in our age group, because we, I don't know, I can't speak for you, Andy, but certainly between sort of Kev and myself, we came through some fairly tough times as Celtic fans, you know, the whole sort of nine in a row, stopping 10 in a row stuff, where it was just like almost a partial generation where there was no success. The team were just, it was survival, and they obviously got through the end of it. But and maybe, I guess I've got a little bit of a theory whether that's the bit that makes you kind of love it more, if you know what I mean. The fact that, you know, it was kind of almost taken away from you, that you realise how important it is to you. And I guess I'm, when, again, it was a future podcast, so we're going to have a chat about whether there's another generation. Because you think of the people who have been going for the past, even the past 10 years, there's been a lot of success in that 10 years, you know, cup winning and, you know, qualifying for Champions League and all those. I think there's been a lot of success. Are they going to have the same passion when really they've known more success than none, if you know what I mean? So, again, that's another debate for another day. That could go on for a long, long time. But I think it's certainly worth worth chatting about. I guess just to see, you know, like Kev's kids and my kids. I mean, my kids, I guess they follow a brand. You know, like my son, my oldest son, first thing I do, if you say, right, you know, go and get out your pyjamas and, you know, get some clothes on, he'll go in, open the drawer, and the first thing he'll do is take out some sort of Celtic t-shirt. Won't take out the hoops. He'll take out like a Celtic, like a training top or something. And that's just what he does. First thing, you know, and it's, I guess I'm kind of proud of the fact that that's what he chooses to go and do. But when he's sort of 17, 18, 19 years old, is he going to be wanting to do the same thing? Is he going to want to go and watch Celtic games at 3 o'clock in the morning with me? Or is it just the fact that he's following a brand, inverted commas? Because he likes, you know, he likes green's his favourite colour and he likes the four-leaf clover. I don't know. Again, as I said, it's a debate for another day. But moving on, Kev. If you're still
How'd
there.
You follow that, Pat?
only thing I can say is I mind 88 being a, you know, a beautiful moment. Cup final, centenary double, mm-hmm. old enough to remember it, and that was just a beautiful day.
It was, without a shadow of a doubt. But I think what you were saying there, Pat, as well, I think you're right. Maybe those of us that went through the really bad times,
aye.
We still had a good laugh when we were going to see the games. We weren't winning much. And when you actually look back and you see how bloody poor we were, and we were mid-table type stuff at some times, and, you know, we were bloody awful. But we had some good fun going to the games, and it's, you remember that. So when the good times did come round again,
singing songs, mind.
No, you weren't.
About, you know, I'm assuming that me and you were both younger men then.
Oh, absolutely, without a shadow.
Aye, aye. Andy. But you know what I'm saying, that you were daft sometimes, and you did sing things that were maybe inappropriate.
Yeah,
but you weren't lifted.
No, that's true. And but I think that was it, because maybe if that was the point you were making, Pat, I would totally agree with that, because we remembered those bad days. When we started winning things, we really appreciate winning things now. Whereas there's maybe that slightly younger generation that they've been used to winning things, so it's not such a big deal to them.
Yep.
And it gets kind of a bit tedious and it gets a bit boring.
Yeah, again, it's a much bigger discussion than probably this one when we're 107 minutes into the damn thing. But I guess I'm just curious whether there is that next generation coming through, I suppose. That's, again, I'm most kind of curious of. And I guess only people back there can tell that. You know, there's no point. Not there's no point, but I guess there's less influence on, you know, my kids here just because they like a Celtic top and they walk around. But are they going to get up at 3 in the morning to watch a game? I think that's going to be fairly tough, you know. But, I mean, I've got mates, you know, even in my local area who are big Celtic fans, and their kids, you know, their rooms are decked out in green and white, and they've got Celtic strips on the walls and on the ceilings, and there's still a real kind of love for the club. So I guess you kind of hope your kids have that same kind of passion. But
yeah, you know, and again, but what will happen, Pat, once we're long gone, there'll be another generation emigrate to, whether it's Australia or Japan or Canada or England or wherever the hell they're going to go, and they'll go themselves, and they'll take Celtic with them just now. I think the longer you're away from the country and the more generations that come behind you, it's obviously going to wane a little bit from the kids, but I've no doubt it'll go on for generation after generation.
I think it'll endure. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
My boys and that, just speaking personally, like, they're you know, they're all Celtic fans. I've got three lads, and you know, they've all got the gear and whatever. And whilst, you know, at the moment, we're okay, we're trackling along, we're going to win the league, that's without a doubt. And the cup, you know, shows have been disappointments. I think, you know, they buy into the ethos of it all. you know, they buy into what we our way of life. You know, I wouldn't say communist, you know, but I mean, you know what I'm saying? Socialist maybe is maybe a wee bit better. But, you know, they buy into that and you see them wearing, it's like your man saying there, they'll put a Celtic tops on. If they're going out to play five-a-side, the Celtic tops on.
Yep.
It's going to keep, it will continue. How can it not? You know, you can't. Maybe as you say, it's rose tinted specs, but you know, it is the right way. If you know what I mean, how can there be any other way? And that's the way we've been brought up. And you know, like you see it as this is the way we should live our lives, and this is the way that it should continue. Yeah, I don't know.
As I said, it's a bigger debate for another day. Let's move on, Kevin.
It's a cracker, though. It's a cracker, man.
I know, but we're 110 minutes in, so, and we keep saying we're going
to
keep these shots.
I've got emails I need to fucking respond to now. I'm getting fucking spreadsheets being sent to me.
I'm forgetting you're working, Andy. Spreadsheets? Out loud, honest to God. No, listen,
check,
I think...
check column 2 on spreadsheet 1. You know, fuck off.
Talking about the selling.
I hope your boss isn't listening in, Andy.
Oh, fucking hell, mate.
Well, I think... Now, are we going to talk about this or are we not? Because we should wrap it up soon. But Liam was talking about making a very interesting point, but we don't know whether we should make this point or not. I'm going to let Liam decide whether he does make this point or not, because it could be quite controversial.
Well, I think we've built it up enough to better get it out there. I'm lucky enough that for a number of years, my family were quite heavily involved with Celtic, with the matchday operation. And as such, I had quite an inside track on how things go on a matchday from the catering side of things. And one thing that that needs to be highlighted is just the, in my opinion, the extremely poor way that the staff are treated.
Mm-hmm.
Because, right, just to give you a bit of background, this is going to take a wee while, but bear with me. To give you a bit of background, basically, Celtic do not do the catering themselves. They outsource it to a company. Now, it's been different companies down the years, but at the moment it's a company called Lindley Catering.
Mm-hmm.
And Lindley Catering are a multinational company. They've got stadiums all over the UK. I'm not sure what stadiums they have at the moment because it changes quite a lot, but they're a national presence. They have some business practices that, let's just say, are less than ethical.
Mm-hmm.
First off, to talk about the wage issue. The staff who work for Lindley directly are not paid per hour. They are paid a shift rate, a flat rate, regardless of how long they actually work.
Mm-hmm.
They are not permitted to take a break as such, which is not illegal, but when you think of the sort of high stress type of job that it is, I think it's a wee bit unfair the kids aren't given a break considering what they have to do.
Mm-hmm.
Also, as you can imagine, a stadium like Celtic Park, there's a lot of waste food left over at the end of the game. And these kids have been working for 4 or 5 hours, they're hungry. But previously, it used to be the case that these kids would be allowed something to eat after the game, after all the fans have been served. And once the kiosks have closed, which is typically 15 minutes into the second half. However, when Lindley came in, they changed the rules and they made it a sackable offence for anyone to eat anything that was left over. So kids have been working for 4 hours, they're starving, and they're not allowed a break, not allowed anything to eat, and they have to carry all this food to the bins and throw it out, and if they eat any of it, they're sacked.
Mm.
That is just ridiculous.
That's ridiculous, aye.
Now, more to the point... this is where now I have to declare a personal interest here because, sadly, my father's business is no longer trading.
Mm-hmm.
My father was running a staff agency for a number of years, and we were, up until the end of last season, the primary supplier of staff to Lindley at Celtic.
Mm-hmm.
So if you bought your half-time pie, half-time whatever, chances are you're probably buying it for one of my dad's staff up mm-hmm. until the end of last season. Now, a lot of people complain about the quality of the food at Celtic. Mm-hmm. And this is due to, one, it's due to Lindley taking the contract for granted and taking the fans for granted in the same way that Celtic do. Mm-hmm. However, in their defence, they are pretty much hamstrung by the contract that they have with Celtic. Now, I can't give you the exact figures, but and again, this data may be a year out of date, but this is how it was going as of last season. I've no reason to believe it's changed. Lindley have to pay Celtic a standard fee of £28,000 per home game that's on the season book, regardless of how many fans are actually there and regardless of how many pies are actually sold.
Mm.
And on top of that, they have to pay Celtic a percentage of the profit as well.
Mm-hmm.
So it has, as far as I know, for the last 2 or 3 years, it has been a loss-making business for them. There's no way they can be making any money out of it, even with the shitty wages that they pay their staff. Also, you know, this clearly shows that Celtic have just signed off this money sale. As long as we're getting our £28,000 a game, we don't care what shite you give the fans, quite frankly. And that, to me, is disgusting. It really is. It's absolutely disgusting that they have just signed away this to a company which treats its staff in a certainly very unethical way. Mm-hmm. It treats the customer with contempt. Their pricing, their menus, and the quality of the food shows absolutely no consideration to what the fans need.
Mm-hmm.
And this is all going on under Peter Lawwell's watchful eye, and he does not give a damn about it, as long as we're still coughing up the money.
Liam, you're going to have the old Scottish mainstream media on you if anybody hears about this now for your exclusives. This is another Carrigan exclusive.
Well, first the Chinese, now it's the mainstream media.
I know. In fact, this isn't Liam Carrigan, this is Liam Carrigan too. Because he was assassinated before by the Chinese army.
Yes,
and
yes.
Secret service.
My esteemed loyal comrades in Beijing have told me not to say anything. No, but seriously, this is where it's at.
Is it still the case where this? I don't know if there's been like new catering contracts, whatever, putting in place. Mm. I swear I have no real knowledge of this, but I've definitely seen photos of like the new fish bar and the new pie shops. Are they still run by the same people? Why?
Yeah, those were a response to, if you remember last season, boy for the website, Mailey's Boys, he did a probe into all this, and he basically kicked up hell, and that was an act of appeasement to the issues that he and his group raised. But it's still very, very poor quality, you know, and that's quite plain to see. The other thing is, which, again, this is a personal thing, but I think it has to be said just to give you a bit of context. As I said, my dad's business is no longer trading, and I'm not looking for sympathy here, but the fact is my parents are about to lose their house because the business has gone under. And now, it's not the only factor. A contributing factor to that is that this company, while they've been creaming it in for Celtic, over the last 2 years, my father issued them with 160 invoices for services performed. Mm-hmm. And more than 150 of them were paid late. Which then means my dad has to dip into his own personal cash flow to make up the wages because the bills are not paid on time. And that created a backlog, and eventually it just finally blows up in your face, then what can you do? So these cretins are stealing for Celtic fans. They are stealing from the club, and they've been stealing from my family as well. So, you know, this may sound like a personal vendetta, and I guess to a certain extent it is, but I do think it serves the greater interest of the Celtic support to get this stuff out in the open as well.
No, I think you're right there with that. Definitely.
Mm. Well, as a guy, William Clark, in the chat room has said, can your information be emailed to the Celtic Trust? So if you're happy to do that sort of thing, then if anyone is listening to this, Yep. Then just drop us an email at the halftheworld88@gmail.com. So that's halftheworld88@gmail.com, and we'll certainly put Liam in touch with whoever people want, if that helps. So thanks, William, for the comment.
Yep, and William, I'll be in touch directly. This needs to be put out there. It needs to be moved around, and awareness needs to be raised, because once again, our club is selling out the fans for the sake of a fast buck, and it's got to stop.
See, in terms of the invoices, was there any explanation given, or has there been any explanation given? Because obviously it's the type of thing your father would take up with them, late payment of invoices, etc.
Well, it's a kind of delicate subject, but basically, we raised the issue with them continuously, and finally they decided that we were no longer required at the stadium. And one of their excuses was because we were creating an inconvenience for them with these payment demands. So basically, by demanding what we wanted to be paid,
or demanding what you were due to be paid.
Rightfully due to be paid.
Now, the thing is, there were other contributing factors, which they would give you other reasons as to why they no longer used our company. But, that was basically... We were, for the last few months, we were put in an impossible position because these bastards were not paying their bills on time. But you can't say anything because it's your main client. And with the thing is, Servco going bust didn't help us either, because we used to service Ibrox and Parkhead. And then about 6 months before they liquidated, they stopped using us. And we found out later why it was, because they didn't have money to use any agencies. We were actually lucky in a sense, because Rangers actually told us, a few months before admin, they said, we'll keep using you, but we can't pay you till February. so they knew fine well what was coming, So we were lucky in that sense. But this is the issue here. It's just these people are a law unto themselves, and it's just big business again, been able to bully the small guy.
Is that just the way? I'm not being trying to belittle anything, but is that the way with all big businesses that they have the power? I mean, I work for a big company, and I know for a fact that we will wait on invoices until the last minute. Because the money is sitting in our account and it's making interest for us.
Yeah.
And until the last red letter comes, then we'll say, right, I will pay you. I know what you're saying, and I'm not trying to belittle you in any way at all.
No, at all, you're exactly right.
Big guy better than the little guy, and saying okay, there's your money. And it's not until the last minute. But it still smacks back. I would just to go back, it harks on it with the club, with this, be Celtic, we're all, more than a club. For them to treat people in the way that this sounds like they are treating people is, it's wrong to publicly pronounce, more than a club, buy the DVD, buy this, be Celtic, and at the same time treat people like shit. That's fucking wrong.
Well, the other thing is,
if you're going to walk the walk, talk the fucking talk, what I'm saying?
Yeah. But the other thing is, my dad actually emailed Peter Lawwell about 3 weeks ago just to outline all these issues. Because it was confirmed a few weeks ago that we were losing the house. My dad thought, we've got nothing to lose now, I might as well tell Celtic how I feel. So he sent Peter Lawwell a letter, a personal type letter, handed it into Celtic Park to Peter Lawwell's secretary, who assured us it would get to him 3 weeks ago, and we'd not even had an acknowledgement yet. So... that shows you what our esteemed chief executive thinks of the situation.
Did you say you've emailed them since, Liam?
No. My father sent them a handwritten letter.
Yeah.
3 weeks ago, handed it into the club in person to the secretary, who assured us it would go straight to his office. So he would have seen them that day if he'd have been in the building, and that was three weeks ago. The other thing is, just to add to this, when our business hit the skids. Our two big contracts that we still had were Celtic and Hampden, right? Now, of course, when we went bust, there was a month's wages that hadn't been paid. So my dad dipped into what was left of our own personal savings to make sure the staff get paid, but there was a shortfall, naturally. Now, this is like 16, 17-year-old Wayne you're dealing with. We wanted to make sure everybody get paid. Mm-hmm. So what we agreed to do with Hampden, we made a deal with Hampden whereby they paid my dad a permanent placement fee of £40 per person, right? And our typical booking was about 80 staff. So there's like 40 times 80, 80 times 40 quid, right, came into us. Mm-hmm. All that money then went to paying staff wages that hadn't been paid. We did not make a penny out of that. Mm-hmm. We offered the same deal to Celtic to say, look, you can take all of our staff that you did use, you were quite happy to use before, and just give us 40 quid a head, and you can have them all, and they're your staff, you can do what you want with them, and it makes sure that all those young kids for the East End of Glasgow are going to have a job.
Mm-hmm.
Linley didn't want to know. They rejected it out of hand, didn't even respond to our inquiry. Hampden had the good sense to realise they wanted to offer the kids a job. They knew they were good kids, knew they were hard workers, and why should they suffer for a business that's become insolvent? Mm-hmm. They did the decent thing. Celtic didn't.
Mm.
So again, you know, more than a club, my arse.
Aye, it makes a bit of a mockery of it, doesn't it?
Aye, exactly.
There you go, Kev. So are you still selling the spot now, Kev, after that?
It's yet again. I must admit, you did say before the show that Liam had a little gem to talk about, and we were maybe going to skim past as well. Liam, no, listen, I'm glad you've mentioned it, mate. I'm glad you've mentioned it here as well. I don't know what the fallout of this is going to be, but I mean, it's quite hard hitting, and it's quite. I have got no reason to doubt a word that's come out of your mouth, mate, but it's certainly posing a few questions in my mind. I find it quite very disappointing that the club could be so dismissive of, I guess, a business that's been providing a service for so long that they actually owed money to, and have obviously contributed in. Well, on the unfortunate circumstances your parents are in just now.
12 years we were servicing Celtic. No, sorry, 10 years. 10 years we were servicing Celtic, and that's the thanks you get, you know.
Yeah, not just as a business, but as a Celtic supporting business as well.
Well, the thing is, we put a lot of money into the club. We bought tables at the Walfred. We bought tables at Number 7. We sponsored Neil Lennon's tribute dinner.
Mm-hmm.
You know. And that's the thanks you get. It's just, you know.
That's shocking, by the way.
Liam, yeah. Do you know what will be unfortunate, though? And again, I know there's only a handful of people listening to this bloody thing, but...
There's a few of us here in the UK that love the show.
But Liam, if people pick up on this and word gets out, now we can fast forward and we know what's going to happen. It's all going to get shouted down and all the rest of it, more than likely. Yeah. But it's good that you've been able to say your piece on here. And obviously, if anybody needs any more information on it, I'm sure we can manage to get people in touch with you, Liam, and you can pass on some more information if needs be. But it would be interesting. I would love to hear, not that I think there's too many people involved with a club up in the higher echelons would be listening to this, but if word gets out at all, it'd be great to hear some kind of response to the comments you've made and the story that you've given on the show tonight, because I'm flabbergasted, I'll be honest with you, mate. It sounds pathetic. It sounds like it's the type of actions that a big multinational conglomerate company would do, Tories would do. It's not what you want to see our club doing. You mentioned it earlier on, Andy, that you know the foundations of our club were formed on good socialist principles and looking after people, and that's for me is a huge part of what Celtic's about. It's come one, come all, and we're all in it together. And it should be a very, I guess, socialist kind of identity that we have. Just hearing some of the stuff that you're describing there, Liam, it's a million miles removed from that, and it's quite sickening to hear, mate, to be honest. And
that was the thing, you know. I was a season ticket holder for a few years before my family got involved with Celtic, and of course, every match day I was still going to see the game, but then before going to see the game, I'd help out my dad with checking the staff in, and you know. And at first, it was great. Oh, behind the scenes at Celtic, it was exciting. But see, when you see the shower of shite that is running that show, it totally, to me, the fantasy, the illusion, the romance of going to see Celtic at Celtic Park, it was completely destroyed. To me, it's just because I know the absolute shambles that goes on behind the scenes, you know?
Like the Wizard of Oz when you draw back the curtain kind of thing.
Aye, exactly. That's exactly it. Aye.
So, Liam, Williams got the email address for the Trust Secretary, and I've just sent it to you on your Facebook account. So
I've just seen that.
Right, so he said if you email that person, I won't say names just in case, email that person just with the info you have, then you know they might be able to take it up. So thanks, William, again for chasing that up. I knew that Liam sort of wanted to say some stuff. I didn't realise it was going to go quite so in-depth, and it was going to be quite so personal, but yes, a bit of a surprise for all of us.
It's good, though. It's good. Well,
it's good to get it out in the open, though.
You know what I mean? It's good to hear it, and
it's therapeutic, I'd say. It's therapeutic.
Get it out. Well, get it out in the open.
Aye, exactly.
At least then we can challenge it, you know what I mean?
Aye.
And Liam, at least you're far enough away in Osaka that they won't be able to hunt you down in 2 hours.
Well, the thing is, what can they sue me for? You know, last I heard, the Tories haven't yet put through a law that says you can be sued for telling the truth. You know,
is it yet?
Don't give them a fucking chance.
Yeah, man, does this come under the fans against criminalisation? Are they going to try and get Liam? Because
Liam's going to be gagged. Liam will be gagged from now on. If Liam's not on any more Half the World Away shows, you'll have an idea why. But it won't be mine and Pat's doing, I'll tell you.
No more Roll of Honor the karaoke for me then.
Hey guys, I've actually got some, to sort of put a lighter note on this, I've got some really exciting news that's just broken. I don't know if you guys have been watching it, but apparently Tom Hanks is the latest celebrity to become a Celtic supporter.
All right.
What's he done?
I don't know, some shite thing in the Scotsman, but anyway, you can go and have a look. Some guy whose name
was
I've never heard of.
Was he a gig with Snoop Doggy Doggy Diggity Dog? Wearing the hoops.
Scots actor Ross McCall has revealed how he's convinced his pal to start following the hoops. Brilliant. So expect him to be at Parkhead for the next game, no doubt. So anyway.
Go on, Hanks, eh?
I like Tom Hanks.
Hanksy number one, CSC.
I like them.
Nice.
The Ellis.
Oh, here we go. This is a class. They've got really. This is really in depth. Captain Phillips star Hanks, 57, previously declared himself a fan of English Premiership side Aston Villa. You ready for this? Because he liked the name.
So my wife's an Aston Villa fan.
So there you go. That's what says it all, really, doesn't it? Celebrity Celtic fans also include Rod Stewart and rapper Snoop Dogg. That's a good ending to Scotsman. That's a really, really interesting article. Bloody hell, man. Why did I read this shit?
By the way, especially when the show's on, Pat, you should be focusing, mate. Focus.
I'm trying to keep up to date with the latest news, Kev. You know, just trying to see what's out there in case there's any breaking news.
Jim White exclusives.
I can tell you that Celtic Underground have got a new podcast. So anyway, that's another story. Or should we talk about them on HailHailMedia, should we?
We should. Andy, what are you trying to say there?
I'm butting in. I apologise. Roddy Forsyth article in the Telegraph about Neil Lennon, about he's not Jekyll and Hyde, you know, and that why has he been treated differently in England and why has he been treated the way he has been in Scotland? It's worth a read.
Was that about a week ago, a week or so ago?
No. It's, I think it was issued the day, 13th of Feb.
No, there was one
yesterday.
There was one about a week ago that was a really cracking article. I sent it to my wife. I mean, she's an Aussie, so she it was just to sort of let her have a look at it. And it was in, I'm just trying to find it, Daily Mail. And it was exactly along the same lines. It was, you know, this whole portrayal.
I know
of
the one
being...
you mean. I mind that myself. No, this is Roddy Forsyth in the Telegraph, obviously, yesterday.
Yeah, I'll go and have a look.
I think it's a simple answer, actually, without even reading the article.
No, yeah.
Irish yeah, Celtic yeah. fans and Celtic yeah. supporters are tolerated yeah. in every country yeah. but Scotland. That's pretty much
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry, maybe
played
I should that.
Leicester and all them other sides, and, no bigotry. Played in yep. Scotland, you know, bottled, you know, assaulted, you know, things thrown at them.
Yeah.
Funny, isn't it? Eh? You know.
It's an
I'm not a fucking genius, but, you know.
I've got no idea why he stuck it out for so long, but anyway, that's another
I'm glad he has. Guys, listen, I'm going to wrap it up, if that's okay with everyone, because time is marching on, and it's well past the witching hour now, and Pat's part of the world. At least it's only half nine in Western Australia. I've got another few Heinekens and I can have. No Carlsberg. Plenty of Heinekens.
It's 1:30 in the UK.
Wonderful. How's your weather pleasure. There, Andy? How is your weather there?
It's fucking pissing down.
Ah, wonderful.
We've got
wonderful.
Fucking gales, rain. The south of England is flooded. You know, tough shit. I'll tell you what's been funny over here. The last budget was all about austerity measures, mm-hmm. you know, like, oh, we're going to have to tighten the belts and all that, like, you know, like, we're all going to have to fucking just scrimp and save. Yeah. Like, the Thames Valley got flooded. Mm-hmm. Right, there'll be as much money as you need.
Oh, of course. the good old Thames. You can't have the banks busting on the Thames.
How fucking strange. You know, like, the south of England gets fucking... financially stricken and money appeals, eh? And talk about the fucking yes no vote. I wish I had a fucking vote in Scotland.
Oh, yeah, interesting. Yeah. That's yeah. definitely another debate for another day. I hear where you're coming from, Andy, and I hear what you're saying and I agree what you're saying, mate.
So this ends the part of the political broadcast on behalf of the Half the World Away podcast. Jesus, seriously, politics, you guys.
Note, guys, sorry, on that note, check out, if you get time, check out Tommy Sheridan's speech.
I've about seen it.
The, how good was that? Seriously.
Tremendous. Well, there's 3/4 of this podcast have nailed their colours to the mast anyway. Pat never, he says he can never be bothered with politics, but that's
boring.
Just Pat.
Yep.
That's no, just Pat. But anyway, guys.
You guys are a fucking credit to the Celtic support around the world. You know, the things, you know, like, as I said before, getting up in the middle of the fucking night and watching games and the boys, you've got clubs and everything down there and you're organising events. Kudos to you, boys.
Andy,
you know,
you'd be doing the same yourself if you were over here, mate. Honestly, it makes it easy.
I'd be a follower. I don't know if I'd be an organiser. I'd be the one of the boys who just turned up. You know what I mean?
Actually, on the news of the event, so we got. Did you see the news, Kev? About this new revelation, the contact that's been made with our beloved leader, Mr. Chris McMonagall.
Oh,
there
yes.
is an Irish rebel band called the Druids. Now, in truth, it's a name to me. I've seen the name around. Couldn't say I've actually ever heard any of the songs. So apparently, they are in the country at the time of. What was now known as the Huddle Down Under, which is a bit of yes. a gathering for Celtic fans on the Gold Coast. So it's not confirmed yet, but they basically have said, would we be interested in them playing a bit of a gig for us? On
yes,
that
we
night,
would.
On the Sunday
Are they
night,
free
so.
Of charge?
No. That's the thing.
All right.
Apparently
well,
they're very, very well
tell
known.
Tell
them
we need to negotiate with something then. I'm sure well, Chris is on to that.
Yeah, I think what they were looking for was something around the $27 mark. For a gig, and apparently they're very good, and they would normally charge double that if it was an actual concert somewhere. So, I think they're trying to help out by sort of reducing costs and stuff like that. But if anyone out there has actually heard the Druids,
Well, I've see them on YouTube. As soon as this is finished, I'm going to go on YouTube them and see what they're like.
Well, you have to go into the Huddle Down. So basically, anyone who's interested in coming along, if there is anyone in Australia actually listening to this pile of nonsense, you can go to Facebook and look, just search for Gold Coast Celtic. And it's just a group on Facebook, and just sort of join that. There's also a Twitter account as well, but in truth, the Facebook group just sort of took over. So that's GC Celtic, as in Gold Coast, GC Celtic on Twitter as well. So, anyone sort of interested, it's definitely anyone who's actually been and seen and heard the Druids in concert, but by all accounts, they're very, very good. So $27, what would that be, Kev? 10, 12 quid?
A little bit more than that, maybe, but about 15, 16, something like that,
yeah,
maybe.
15 quid, so apparently it's normally a lot more than that to go and see them live, especially like, they must be touring Australia or something like that, but obviously it's a long way to come, and by all accounts, so we're trying to set up a gig on the Saturday night in Brisbane, and they contacted the Brisbane Celtic Supporters Club, not them, but obviously the promoters did, and the guys up there went, well, good luck, because we're not going to be here, we're going to be down the Gold Coast.
Tremendous.
So yes, that's so hopefully they're going to come and join us. And the other exciting thing, Kev, now you can't tell anybody this, but we have, not we, Chris has managed to arrange the one and only Lisbon Lion, Willie Wallace.
Oh yes,
to be involved in our little weekend. So
I was hoping that might happen, because Willie's in Brisbane anyway, isn't he?
I think he's on the Gold Coast, isn't he? He's up that way anyway. So anyway,
he's that neck of the woods.
So what it's going to be potentially, and this is just a little bit of a rumour, I'm letting you know, Kev. You know, there's a football game on the Saturday.
Are you allowed to be saying this, Patrick?
Probably not.
You may keep this as a secret.
Chris will probably chastise me. He doesn't listen to this anyway, so that's all right. So anyway, yeah. There's a football game going on the Saturday. So it's basically
soccer
game going on. So we're got a big event at a soccer club. Now, apparently, Willie Wallace is going to be coach of one of those teams.
Nice.
That was pretty cool. So, yes, so that's some added little stuff. So, I've got, which I haven't really promoted to anyone yet, but Andy McCabe, who's a Celtic fan and is a singer-songwriter, performer up in the Brisbane area. He's going to do stuff for us on the Friday night. We've got Saturday...
Roll of Honour on repeat.
I'm not sure it's Irish kind of stuff. We've got the football game on the Saturday afternoon. We've got the Willie Wallace, maybe a Q&A session followed by that. And then we've got the big band night and stuff like that on the Saturday night. And then on the Sunday, we've got the boat cruise followed by potentially the Druids on the Sunday night as well. So,
what more can you ask for? Pat, you better tell people the dates. Remind people of the dates.
It's June the 6th. So it's Friday, June the 6th. Everything kicks off with the... it's kind of a meet and greet on the Friday night. Actually, I tell a lie. There's a golf day on Friday if you're there early. There's a golf sort of... one of these big golf clubs. I can't remember what it is. It's just around, half around, whatever it is. But there's a golf thing going on the Friday afternoon. Then there's a bit of a meet and greet thing on the Friday when most people are kind of flying in and heading up to the Gold Coast. And then, yeah, it just kicks off from there. So it's... I've got no idea how I'll actually last to the Sunday, but that's another story for another day.
Ah, Pat, you'll last easy, mate. You can nurse a few pints, mate, over the course of the weekend. You'll be fine.
Yep, and we're actually talking, Kevin.
You can watch me and Stevie Harvey getting battered into it.
And we may do an actual podcast from up there, Kevin. We'll see how we go.
Well, there has been talk of this, Pat. We'll need to see how we go. You'll need to bring your van full of equipment.
Oh, no, dead easy.
Satellite and all that.
Easy peasy. So that's not an issue, but we'll see how we go. I know it's a long way away, but so anyone who's in Australia, in the sort of, you know, this, I guess, neck of the woods, we're going to say, but this part of the world, get yourself to the Gold Coast. It's going to be, it's going to be fairly good. Not quite up to your convention in America kind of levels, but it's the first point of call, I guess, is our first attempt at doing it.
We've got to start somewhere, haven't we? Yeah. We've got to start somewhere.
For us little piddly Celtic fans in the big country down under. So, all right, anyway, I think that's probably enough from me.
It's good, Pat, it's good. I'm going to come back to you later on, mind you, for your Jockstein CSC shout-outs. But what about yourself, Liam? Have you got anything you'd like to say, mate? Are you still with us, or have Celtic put a gag on you?
No. Nothing really comes to mind. No.
How's the Osaka CSC coming along?
Well, unfortunately, I've only met one other Scottish person until I've been here, and he's a Sefconian.
Oh, for Christ.
Good guy.
Yep. You get that.
Aye. One of those ones, he must have been dropped on his head as a child, you know.
So no shout-outs at all. How's the romancing going on this Happy Admin Day as well? You've been doing a bit of romancing relatively recently. Is that still going strong, or are you?
Yes, all going well.
But obviously, you've been taking up most of the evening on this podcast. You're obviously not romancing, or maybe you are romancing while you're doing this. I don't know what's going on.
Too much information. That's
iPad isn't big enough to use with one hand. Don't worry, boys.
Get your explicit labels.
Well, you started it.
Is there an innuendo label, Pat, for this show as well?
No, a potty mouth is certainly a potty mouth section. But
potty mouth label. Oh, right, Andy, it's been nice to have you on the show, mate. Thanks for calling in. You've made a good contribution.
Thank you very much, guys. Thanks for having me on the show. It's been absolutely fantastic.
It's a nice way to spend your day at work.
Well, I'm getting back to this Excel spreadsheet now. It's fucking doing my head, and I fucking lost with it. Can I just say, though, the Leicester Celtic Supporters Club are running a bus up for the Inverness game. I'm just
going to Leicester CSC.
I vary my time between Ellesmere Port and Leicester. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Inverness game on the 1st. So if anybody's interested, check out Leicester CSC. We've got the Twitter page there. Mm-hmm. I think it's just at Leicester CSC. Yeah, okay, it's as simple as.
surely they're called the Neil Lennon CSC in Leicester, surely?
No, there's two clubs in Leicester. There was a wee bit of a schism there, unfortunately. And there is the Neil Lennon Leicester CSC, and there is the Leicester CSC.
The Leicester Neil Lennon CSC.
There's no animosity between the two clubs. It was just a wee bit of a parting of ways, you know what I mean?
These things happen.
Aye. It's a long story.
But it's good to see Leicester's get two CSCs, first and foremost.
Yeah.
Good stuff.
It's a shame.
Any more shout-outs, Andy?
No, boys, thank you very much for having me on. I really appreciate it. And as I say, you guys are a fucking credit. Do you know what I mean? You're thousands of miles away and you know as much about the club as us guys that live, you know, on the doorstep. No. All the best, boys. Hail, hail.
Good on you, Andy. No wonder the UK economy is in the state it is when all these guys are meant to be working and they're phoning into these Celtic podcasts. Nah, good on you, Andy. It's been a pleasure having you on, mate, and hopefully you'll join us again soon.
I'll definitely, mate. It's great to talk to you. You sound like a great bunch of guys. One day, I hope we all meet up and have a great laugh.
Good on you, Andy. Good on you, mate.
Hail, hail, fellas.
And I suppose from my own point of view, I'll give a shout out as usual to everybody back in Coatbridge and the Irngobrass CSC. Anybody at all that's listened from the Mandurah CSC, especially my big mucker Dennis Doherty, who had a good gab with the other night there. Now we've got the game against St Johnson this weekend. We haven't even talked about it at all, but it is St Johnson, isn't it?
Yes.
I believe it is on Sunday. So this is the first game for quite a little while that has been broadcast on Satana over here. So we will be showing it in Friar Tuck's in the warning up area of Mandurah. So if anybody's in the Mandurah or the South Perth area or just passing through on your holidays or visiting or whatever, look us up. You can find us on Twitter at Mandurah CSC. That's Mandurah CSC. You can send us a little tweet there. Or you can contact myself on Twitter at KJPO'Neil72 if you want to give us a little tweet. But other than that, I think that's about it. I don't think there's much more else. You've covered off the Gold Coast stuff, Pat, which is all good, of course. What's happening in the Jockstein CSE?
I don't know. I'll be totally blunt with you. I've got no idea. I've been totally detached from what's going on in recent times, so...
They'll be showing the game. They'll be showing the game on Sunday, I take it. If it's on Satana, they'll probably be showing it. It's an 8:45 kickoff here, so 11:45 kickoff over there.
Yeah, 11:45 on a Sunday night. Yeah. It's going to be fairly tough for some people, but I'm working the next morning, so
yeah.
I don't think I wouldn't even probably see it. But anyway, I should take a sick day. Anyway, we'll see how we go. I guess only announcement, I guess, is just again. What we spoke about before, the Celtic Trust, and just to try and get the background on it, if you go to the www.celtictrust.net, it's got the stuff in there about, you know, the whole role of honour and basically the background of it. And there's, I think there was an article as well from the actual Irish Brigade. Yeah, there was. About why, just the, I guess the background of it and how they, I guess how they came to write the song and all that sort of stuff. So, which is an interesting read. So yeah, just if you jump in there. We will be playing out with that song at the end, so whether you agree with it, disagree with it, we as a Half a World Away podcast decided at the start of the show that that's what we would play out with, just because I guess we want to support the cause, I suppose. I think that's pretty much it. So,
absolutely.
So anyone else? Anything else? No, everyone finished? No more?
All done and dusted, Patrick. You can
2.5 hours, Kev. It's all good. 2.5 hours. We managed to sneak it in. Jesus, unbelievable. Yeah, Dinkum, man. We need to stop
this. Okay, lads.
So, thanks everyone for... thanks to William Clark as well in the chat room, who was obviously sort of checking some stuff up for us.
And listen, I should also, Pat, sorry, I should give a shout out because I meant to earlier on ages ago, but then we changed topic. Gary Boy Somerset, Tim, he tweeted in earlier on. Thanks for your tweet, Gary. And Stevie K, Evil Knievel, he tweeted in as well earlier on. So sorry I never get round to mentioning your comments earlier on, boys, but the topics were moving on, unfortunately. So, but I'll shout out and thanks for tweeting in anyway. We'll maybe get you next time.
Easy peasy. All right, we done, dusted?
Done and dusted. Yep. Hail, hail, boys. Play us out, Patrick.
All right,
hail, hail. Good night.
The roll of honor for Ireland's bravest men. We must be united in memory of the ten. England, you're a monster. Don't think that you have won. We will never be defeated while Ireland has songs.
The dreary H-block cages where brave young Irishmen lay, hungering for justice while their young lives ebbed away. For the rights of Irish soldiers to free their native land, they stood beside their leader, the gallant Bobby Sands.
Lead the roll of honour for Ireland's bravest men. We must be united in memory of the ten. England, you're a monster. Don't think that you have won. We will never be defeated while Ireland has such sons.
Francis Hughes and old Bellahy, Ray McCreesh from Armagh Hills. In the narrow streets of Derry, they miss O'Hara still. They so proudly gave their young lives to break Britannia's hold. Their names shall be remembered as history unfolds.
torn streets of Ulster, the black flags that proudly wave to salute the Irish martyrs, the bravest of the brave. Joe MacDonald, Martin Horson, Kevin Lynch, Kieran Doherty, they gave their lives for freedom with Thomas McAwee. We the roll of honour for Ireland's bravest men. We must be united in memory of the ten. England, you're a monster. Don't think that you have won. We will never be defeated while Ireland has such sons. Michael Devine from Derry, you were the last to die. When your nine brave companions with the martyrs they did lie, your souls cry out, remember, our debts were not in vain. You fought to make our homeland a nation once again. Read the roll of honour for Ireland's bravest men. We must be united in memory of the ten. England, you're a monster. Don't think that you have won. We will never be defeated while Ireland has its song.